America needs a full-time president. President. And a full-time Congress. Congress.
It tends to remain the master of its own house.
Congress.
The Comptroller General of the United States is the Director of the Government Accountability Office, or GAO, formerly known as the General Accounting Office, a legislative branch agency founded by Congress in 1921 to ensure the fiscal and managerial accountability of the federal government. The Comptroller General has the responsibility to audit the financial statements that the Secretary of the Treasury and the Director of the Office of Management and Budget present to the Congress and the President. For every fiscal year since 1996, when consolidated financial statements began, the Comptroller General has refused to endorse the accuracy of the consolidated figures for the federal budget, citing 1. Serious financial management problems at the Department of Defense. 2. The federal government's inability to adequately account for and reconcile intragovernmental activity and balances between federal agencies. And 3. The federal government's ineffective process for preparing the consolidated financial statements. The following is a short interview with myself and former U.S. Comptroller General David Walker.
Most of the government is based on the 40s and 50s. A lot of it's outdated, a lot of it's ineffective. You can't get government employees to function city governments. You have to have a special process that will make this thing transparent, put it out there, and then force a vote, like the bracket, on a rebaseline. It's going to take an extraordinary process because this is tough stuff.
Thanks, Mr. Walker, those figures that you had up there, was that the taxpayer budget that you were referring to?
Which one are you talking about?
You had figures up there.
Yeah. Here.
What is that referring to?
Well, this is the size of the budget as a percentage of the economy, okay?
This is the tax that's collected, is it?
No, here's the total settings. Here's the taxes, okay? Here's the one that has taxes, okay? We had a $1.4 trillion deficit last year. We expect to have about $1.4 trillion deficit this year alone. So
a deficit in what? In the money the federal government collects?
Yeah. The difference between what we pull in and what we pay.
As far as tax, or is that all revenue?
We spent last year this year we're estimating we're going to spend $3.5 trillion. All right?
That's total everything?
That's total everything. Okay. We're going to take in about $2.1 trillion in revenues. That's from corporate income taxes, personal income taxes, payroll taxes, fees, and all that kind of stuff.
So
right?
can you tell me the difference then between this and the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, which shows trillions and trillions of dollars that the government has?
Here's the difference.
Investments.
The difference is, this is the budget, which is cash-based.
In other words, money that comes from the taxpayer goes in,
right,
comes out.
Right, but it's cash-based. It's not accrual-based. And then the financial statements are accrual-based, all right? And so, therefore, that's why you get the numbers like I talked about, $38 trillion for Medicare, $7.8 trillion, because the government accounts for it cash in, cash out. They don't look at, on the budget, doesn't look at the future obligations.
Right, but why isn't the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report actually shared with the people? I know it's a public document because all corporations
Yeah, it comes out about December.
It.
Well, yeah, but it's not a corporation.
But it's kind of the best kept secret.
It comes out about December 15th of each year. This year it came out later, all right? It's something that we push on our website, pgpf.org. Not the actual report, because the actual report's about date. Nobody's going to read it. We do a citizen's guide to the State of the Union finances, graphics, charts, graph, bigger print, pulls together numbers from here, right. Here, and here. Look at that. That's what you
Well, I guess my question really is, if say, 2008 or 2007, government pulled in collectively, according to the Comprehensive Annual Financial Reports, which is the full budget, pulled in about $14 trillion, whereas the public, after taxation, pulled in about $5
trillion. You're talking about the economy.
I'm talking about the whole of the United States. When you take into consideration all 185,000
government. You're talking about the economy, okay? The economy is The economy right now is about 14.5 trillion. That's the U.S. economy.
That's what the government pulls in.
No, that's not what the government
pulls in. Yes, it is, actually. That's what they pulled in 2007. With taxation
trillion.
Plus all of the investments, your condos that you build in
Australia.
Well,
that's the economy. That's not the government.
Well, what is the government doing with all of these investments? Why does the U.S.
They're not government.
Why does the federal government own 95% of Nevada and 97%
okay,
of Utah?
That's an issue of federal lands. Okay, federal minerals.
That's
okay.
That's
an
asset.
And,
right?
That's correct. But you are correct in saying that that's not on the balance sheet. They don't value that because they have no intention to sell it. All right. I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm just trying to explain it.
Is it the government's land or is it our land?
Well,
it's the people's land.
It's supposed to be.
Yeah.
Well,
no,
but if the government is a corporation and it's actually 185,000 different corporations, how is something that's owned by a corporation our land?
Government is not a corporation.
Yes, it is, most certainly. All corporations have to file a comprehensive annual financial report.
Yeah, no, but the government is not a corporation.
It most certainly is.
I can assure you it's not.
Really?
It's wrong.
The government is not a corporation.
Are the
It does file a comprehensive annual financial report, but the reason it does that is because there's a federal law that says that has to be done. I was the Auditor General of the United States.
I know, that's why I'm asking.
I'm the one that had to sign off. There's something called the Chief Financial Officers Act.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's what the requirement is. That has nothing to do with it being a corporation.
Why is it that all this money is sitting there, trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars, worldwide investments, and yet we always only see the taxpayer budget that's always in the red?
What I can say
that's my question.
There's two issues, and then I got to go on to something else because I got another speech. All right.
This is really
number
the only
one,
issue.
Number one, there's a difference between the economy, which the government doesn't control. All right, the government is a percentage of the economy. This year, the federal government's 24% of the economy. All right, which is higher than average. Right? There's a difference between that, which the government controls, and things that are controlled by the government, and so. The 14-point something is a lot of things the government don't control, all right? Most of it doesn't. 76% it doesn't. On the other hand, you make a valid point to say there are some things that the government does control that is not providing adequate transparency as to the value. State lands, mineral rights, etc. And I and others are trying to end up changing the accounting rules on some of that so that we have it. Then it's a different issue as to whether or not you dispose of it on what basis you dispose of it.
When we look at these reports, though, I'm sorry to keep harping on this, but I look and I see if I add up all of the stock investments, I see that the government actually has controlling interest, through stock in most Fortune 500 companies, including Microsoft, 83%. How they own 87% of everything.
You'll have to send me an email as to how you get that.
You can actually go to CAFR1.com, talk to a man named Walter Beery.
Well,
you've probably heard of him.
Just send me an email.
Thank you, sir.
Just send me an email.
I appreciate your time.
That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's click from We Are Change. Signing off.
At the end of this interview, Mr. Walker is obviously flustered. Lying will do that to a man. And at the mentioning of collective government investment followed by Walter Burian's name, this crook was obviously through with me. He turns and asks the puzzled man looking to my right, who has said nothing for the last 7 minutes, and asks him about his question, which he didn't ask. Boy, this is fun. As a polished politician and public affairs professional, the former Comptroller General is caught here in a lie so astronomical and outrageous that his smile and posturing almost fool us into thinking he actually believes his own preposterous rhetoric. You know, there is no worse feeling than when a person, especially a corrupt politician, lies right to your face. So let's take a closer look at the Honorable David M. Walker. Dave is president and CEO of the Peter G. Peterson Foundation. In this capacity, he leads the foundation's efforts to promote federal financial responsibility today in order to create more opportunity tomorrow. Opportunity for who? Prior to assuming his position with the foundation in March of 2008, Dave served as the 7th Comptroller General of the United States and head of the U.S. Government Accountability Office, or GAO, for almost 10 years. Now remember that office, the Government Accountability Office? We're going to bring that up a little later. A little farther down, it says that Dave is chairman of the United Nations Independent Audit Advisory Committee, as a member of the Public Company Accounting Oversight Board Advisory Committee, and as a member of the Trilateral Commission. Now, most members of these organizations like the Trilateral Commission aren't so forthcoming about their memberships. Hey, let's look at that again. The Honorable David M. Walker. Now, in future presentations, I'll discuss the Peter G. Peterson Foundation, its main objectives, where the money comes from, and its involvement with the Agenda 21 efforts in this country. Let's examine what the former Auditor General of the United States said during this interview. "The big lie. The government is not a corporation, I assure you." When I heard this come out of Mr. Walker's mouth, I nearly laughed. Apparently, he thought I wouldn't follow up on this little talk we had. But he was wrong. And the first person to receive this documentary will be Mr. David Walker. After all, he gave me his card and asked for more information. So here it is, Dave. Let's start with my own town, Salt Lake City, in the great state of Utah, very near to where this interview took place. I was sent a letter not too long ago for a parking violation that I never received from the Salt Lake City Law Department. Here, now, is a picture of that letter. Now you'll notice that the first thing you see is that this letter is indeed from the Salt Lake City Corporation. This is the government of the city of Salt Lake. And it doesn't really get any plainer than that. Now, in the first paragraph, it states that I am in default on the debt which I owe to the Salt Lake City Corporation, which they have cleverly nicknamed the City, for outstanding parking fines. The City, meaning the corporation or municipality, acting on behalf of the City, demands that I pay the entire amount due, plus what I am assuming is a late fee no later than 10 days from the date of this letter. And as we read on, after numerous threats of retaliation, the confiscation or theft of my vehicle, and a negative ding on my credit rating, the Salt Lake City Corporation actually has the nerve to tell me to please govern myself accordingly. Then, they tell me that I can't pay this bill in cash, and that I'm supposed to make my check payable to the Salt Lake City Corporation. Now, if you don't comprehend the tyrannical, corporate fascist nature of this threatening letter, perhaps this will help. When I did a search on the internet for information on the Salt Lake City Corporation, this page came up in the results. And there in the description section it states, "The Salt Lake City Corporation is a private company, categorized under fire protection, local government, and located in Salt Lake City, Utah." So my city government is a private corporation? Not public, but private? Translation, the former Comptroller General lied through his bald, crooked, smiling face. Further down in the description box, it states that the location type for the Salt Lake City Corporation is a branch. A branch? Trees have branches, all connected to one large trunk. But wait a minute. What other businesses have branches? Ah, how about banks? I bank with Wells Fargo at one of their local banking branches. This simply means that this is one of hundreds of sub-corporate hubs which all link to the mother corporation, or the tree trunk, that is Wells Fargo Bank, the main corporation. And in truth, Wells Fargo Bank is probably connected to another mother corporation. McDonald's would be another example, this time using franchises, which pay the main corporation of McDonald's to be under its corporate protection, using its name and following its general business practices and standards while appearing to stand independent from the mother corporation. Does this mean that the Salt Lake City Police Department is owned by a private company, considering the reference to the Salt Lake City Corporation's law department? Have our police become nothing more than corporate security? there to protect and serve the corporate interests of the city and state? The real question is, how can a government be a branch of another corporation? Is Salt Lake City just a subcorporate hub under another larger corporation? Well, needless to say, this really threw me for a loop, and so I decided to look at other governments within the great state of Utah. And I found something very interesting. Here is an official website for the United States District Court for the state of Utah. The problem is, it doesn't refer to Utah as a state. Instead, it recognizes Utah only as a district. Here it states, the United States District Court for the District of Utah. After some research, I found that the two-letter abbreviations that all 50 states have been assigned are simply federal district locator codes. States are still called by their full original names, in name only. And you thought your state abbreviation was just for your convenience, so that you didn't have to write it out on letters, perhaps? Are other states in the same predicament? You betcha. Here is the state constitution for the state of Ohio. Now, an interesting note about Ohio, instead of entering and leaving what most states call the city limit, the signs in Ohio state that you are entering or leaving the corporation limit. Here are a few snapshots of these signs. This one is especially interesting, a 40-year before and after shot. Notice that the sign has changed, and a new speed limit is now posted for entrance into the corporation known as Gambier. This is common as each corporation has different speed limits. It also ensures that certain percentages of taxpayers will be speeding once they cross the corporate line. And that means speeding tickets. And that, my friends, means corporate revenue. Back to the Ohio State Constitution. When I click on the link, Organization of Cities, etc., I get the following page. The General Assembly shall provide for the organization of cities and incorporated villages by general laws and restrict their power so as to prevent the abuse of such power. Now, the key word here is obviously incorporated, but also organization is a corporate term, just as businesses are organized and then reorganized in a bankruptcy. And just as the United States as a federal corporation has been reorganized more than one time in its history. In order to qualify this as true and break through the belief system set up by the corporate media, you may pause this video now and read this statement by Republican James Traficant, which is in congressional record and was stated before he was thrown into jail. In Corporate Bankruptcy Code, Chapter 9 bankruptcies are allowed only for state municipalities. Chapter 9 bankruptcies are a form of corporate reorganization and not liquidation. So just what is a municipality? To get the answer to this, I went to a commonly used website named Wikipedia. Now, I don't usually use Wikipedia as a source, but in this case I made an exception. The information is well-sourced and easily verifiable. A municipality, or municipal corporation, is the legal term for a local governing body, including but not necessarily limited to cities, counties, towns, townships, charter townships, villages, and boroughs, like the five boroughs which comprise New York City proper. Municipal incorporation occurs when such municipalities become self-governing corporate entities under the laws of the state or province in which they are located. Often, this event is marked by the award or declaration of a municipal charter from the state of incorporation. Let's take one of the largest states as an example. Do you live in California? If so, which corporation do you live in? There are 480 incorporated municipalities in California, of which 458 are called cities and 22 are called towns. Under California law, the terms city and town are explicitly interchangeable, See Government Code, Sections 34500 through 34504. So, the name of a municipal corporation can either be City of blank or Town of blank, regardless of its population. The term township is obsolete. The terms villages and borough have never been used in California. Here's an alphabetical list, and I'll bet that you find your own city or town. Notice that the left-hand column lists the city or municipality, the middle column lists the county where that municipality is housed, which is a totally separate corporate entity with its own local, national, and international investments and enterprise operations that must also file a comprehensive annual financial report every end of business year. And the right-hand column shows the date of incorporation for the city or municipality, some going more than a century back in history. Are you sweating yet, Mr. Walker? Which corporation do you live in? Ah, there's Sacramento, my hometown. So let's use California as our example state. California has one of the largest economies in the world. All of this business is conducted within the over 18,000 different governments within the state, each one a separate incorporated entity. If you have a private business incorporated anywhere within the state of California, it must be incorporated within one of these municipalities and within the state's corporate guidelines. Each corporate city or town that was just listed has within them other municipal corporate structures like school districts, pension funds, utility companies, city councils, and even enterprise operations such as golf courses, movie theaters, malls, etc., etc. As stated earlier, the government owns just about everything you see through collective investment. But you must not think of these as just individual corporations, for as we saw above with the Salt Lake City Corporation, these more than 18,000 corporate governments in California are like bank branches as well. The only way to get a grasp on the power, wealth, prosperity, land, and property ownership of the state of California is to take all of these over 18,000 individual corporate governments, including school districts, counties, the state corporation, municipalities, enterprise operations, cities, towns, pension funds, etc., not forgetting its foreign investments and operations, for instance, CalSTRS is now an offshore multinational corporation, and then add up their collective private investments and count them as branches or sub-corporations of one main corporation, which is California Incorporated. What better way to hide the wealth of the corporate government than to divide it up into thousands and thousands of branches, making it nearly impossible to add up the actual ownership and wealth of the government as a whole? But don't stop there, for then you must consider that collectively, between the municipalities and individual corporate governments within all 50 of the United States proper, America houses over 185,000 different corporate governments, municipalities, and entities, which we might as well call branches. Now, the word collective is vital to comprehend here, for as one giant framework of a country, this collective corporate United States government owns almost everything in sight, and this will be shown later in this presentation. The United States has now been almost completely privatized, with land and municipalities often being sold off to foreign investors and foreign private corporations. In fact, under Executive Order 12803, signed by then-President of the United States, George H.W. Bush, in 1992, the Corporation of the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., neither a state nor a part of the 50 states united, This federal corporate government was given the authority to privatize most or all of the infrastructure within the United States without congressional consent or vote. This means that the federal government, or the corporation that acts in lieu of a federal government, can and has allowed the selling of any municipalities, or city, or any government's assets which were built with taxpayer monies, including but not limited to roads, tunnels, bridges, electricity supply facilities, mass transit, rail transportation, airports, ports, waterways, recycling wastewater treatment facilities, solid waste disposal facilities, hospitals, prisons, schools, and housing. Executive Order 12803 lists these as examples of America's saleable and/or leasable infrastructure. But this is not to be taken as a complete list, as these are just some examples of what our government has been selling off to foreign investors for almost 20 years. Executive Order 12803 names this authority in its destructive pages as infrastructure privatization, and states that this power allows for the, quote, disposition or transfer of an infrastructure asset, such as by sale or by long-term lease from a state or local government to a private party. Now, wasn't it our good friend David Walker who said that the government isn't interested in selling off these assets that they don't list on the taxpayer budget?
Well, what is the government doing with all of these investments? Why does the U.S. Why does the federal government own 95% of Nevada and 97% of Utah?
That's an issue of federal lands, okay? Federal minerals.
That's an asset, right?
That's correct. But and you are correct in saying that that's not on the balance sheet. They don't value that because they have no intention to sell it. All right. I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm just trying to explain it.
Is it the government's land or is it our land?
It's the people's land. It's
supposed to be.
if the government is a corporation and it's actually 185,000 different corporations, how is something that's owned by a corporation our land?
Government is not a corporation.
Yes, it is. Most certainly. All corporations have to file a comprehensive annual financial report.
Yeah, no, but the government is not a corporation.
It most certainly is.
I can assure you it's not.
Really?
It's wrong.
The government is not a corporation.
When we look at Executive Order 12803, Infrastructure Privatization, we read in Section 1, Definitions, for purposes of this order, A, privatization means the disposition or transfer of an infrastructure asset, such as by sale or by long-term lease from a state or local government to a private party. In other words, the selling of taxpayer-funded infrastructure to private corporations or individuals. B, infrastructure asset means any asset financed in whole or in part by the federal government, in other words, taxpayer money, and needed for the functioning of the economy. Examples of such assets include, but are not limited to, roads, tunnels, etc. And D, transfer price means the amount paid or to be paid by a private party for an infrastructure asset if the asset is transferred as a result of a competitive bidding. This, my friends, is why the carpool lanes on your freeways and highways have turned into toll roads that you must pay to use. A private corporation now leases or owns those lanes, either outright or through public-private partnerships, or PPPs, despite being built with your taxpayer monies. This is also why closed-circuit TV cameras are now mounted just about everywhere you look, monitoring your every move at every major intersection that you cross. This is why the parking police in Hollywood are actually part of a private corporation based in New York City that only hires minorities and who takes no oath to the Constitution. This is why the parking meters in downtown Chicago now cost $27 to park for only half an hour. They were sold off and leased to private enterprises. And this is why your gas, electric, sewer, trash, and other utility prices are going through the roof. Privatization means deregulation. Deregulation means no limitations on pricing due to the monopolistic authority granted by the state through these partnerships. This is the privatization of America, referred to above as infrastructure privatization. This is corporate fascism, rule by corporate government proxy. This is the corporatization of the United States. In another article by Eanthogene Dugan, entitled Facing Budget Gaps, Cities Sell Parking, Airports Zoo, she writes, cities and states across the nation are selling and leasing everything from airports to zoos, a fire sale that could help plug budget holes now but worsen their financial woes over the long run. California is looking to shed state office buildings. Milwaukee has proposed selling its water supply. In Chicago and New Haven, Connecticut, its parking meters. In Louisiana and Georgia, airports are up for grabs.
And you are correct in saying that that's not on the balance sheet. They don't value that because they have no intention to sell it. All right? I'm not saying that's right or wrong. I'm just trying to explain it.
Is it the government's land or is it our land?
Well,
it's the people's land. Oh.
Supposed to be. Yeah.
Many governments are using asset sales to balance budgets ravaged by declines in tax revenues and unfunded pensions. In recent congressional testimony, billionaire investor Warren Buffett said he worried about how municipalities will pay for public workers, retirement, and health benefits, and suggested that the federal government may ultimately be compelled to bail out states. Remember, a bailout means a purchase. Some properties are being sold at fire sale prices into a weak market. The deal means cities are giving up long-term, recurring income streams in exchange for lump-sum payments to plug one-time budget gaps. The current deals are fundamentally different because control of the asset transfers to private hands. The most popular deals in the works are metered municipal street and garage parking spaces. One of the first was Chicago, where the city received $1.16 billion in 2008 to allow a consortium led by Morgan Stanley to run more than 36,000 metered parking spaces for 75 years. The city continues to set the rules and rates for the meters and collect the parking fines, but the investors keep the revenues, which this year will more than triple the $20 million the city was collecting, according to credit rating firms. In other words, if you live in Chicago, Morgan Stanley is charging you for parking on the streets that your fathers built. Based on the new rates, the inspector general claimed the city was shortchanged by about $1 billion. The investors will make their money back in 20 years, and we are stuck for 50 more years making $0. Around the country, at least a dozen public parking systems are up for bid, including in San Francisco and Las Vegas. In Pittsburgh, the mayor is proposing to lease out the parking system for an upfront sum of about $300 million over 50 years and funnel the money back into the pension system. But the city will ultimately lose $3.5 billion over the life of the lease. And guess which group will ultimately have to make up that deficit? You got it. You, the taxpayer. Remember, the corporation is not interested in good fiscal policy. Its sole purpose is to make its shareholders a profit. Water supply is also being sold to private interests. In Milwaukee, a consumer advocate called a plan to sell the water system mortgaging Milwaukee's future. The report by Washington-based Food and Water Watch says private water service in general costs 59% more as new owners seek to recoup their investment. Water users cannot vote private managers or state-appointed regulators out of office. When you as the public cannot vote your officials out of office, you as the public do not have a constitutional or representative government. Airports are also being privatized under a limited federal program. Now, you may have noticed that one of the saleable items in the above list was housing. Strange as that sounds, the truth is even stranger. Here's the deal. You are not the owner of your land or your home. You are actually listed as a tenant on your title and deed, regardless of whether your home is paid in full or not. You may stay in your home under one condition, that you pay your property taxes. Property tax can simply be defined as extortion or racketeering. It is rent paid to the government, municipality, county, and state for which your house resides as protection money, so that your house is not confiscated. If you believe this to be untrue, that you are indeed the master of your own home, then I would invite you to stop paying your rent in the form of property tax to the government. The corporate police will be summoned to remove you from your home for your lack of payment of property tax, and your land and home will be reabsorbed into the municipality and probably sold at auction to the next fool who thinks that they have the freedom and right of ownership. Eminent domain is virtually undefendable, as you were never the property owner in the first place. This is the corporatization of liberty. So just what is corporatism? The word corporation is derived from the Latin word corpus, which translates into English as body. Formal corporatist models are based upon the contract of corporate groups such as agriculture, business, ethnic, labor, military, patronage, scientific, or religious affiliations into a collective body. There's that word again, collective. For instance, all individual Methodist churches pay the main corporate church, which is indeed a for-profit corporation, with each of their individual 501c3 houses of worship across the country and the world acting as their non-profit branches. This is why all denominations hold general conferences. They are nothing but giant corporate budget meetings. In this way, churches can be regulated by the state. Yes, churches are corporations. And yet, almost humorously, we demand our Bill of Rights and the right to our freedoms of religion as we sit and assemble at corporate houses of worship that have been infiltrated by greed and usury, all the while not comprehending that the Constitution we hold so dear provides for not only religious freedom, free of corporate tyranny and control, but for the freedom to peacefully assemble without government interference and without taxation of any kind. Non-profit status for churches is a redundancy that is both repugnant and absolutely unnecessary. This is the corporatization of God. And yes, the military, as a government-owned entity, as a constitutionally forbidden standing army, is a corporately held private world police force, currently guarding poppy seeds in Afghanistan, oil fields in Iraq, and having bases of operation in just about every country in the world. This is the state of the corporate military today, to protect and serve the continuity of the government, or the corporation. This is the corporatization of war. This age-old recipe of corporatism and fascism has been utilized by most ideologies across the political spectrum, including absolutism, capitalism, conservatism, fascism, liberalism, progressivism, reactionism, social democracy, socialism, and syndicalism. Churches throughout history, including Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Confucianism, have set up and continue to adhere to corporatist structures. Interestingly, the idea of a central bank is actually one of the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto. And indeed, all of these Marxist ideals of how to turn a government into a communist state have been made into law in the United States federal government through executive orders, presidential directives, acts of Congress, and other legislation. Equally as intriguing, the term democracy is actually a communist term, completely opposite of the constitutional idealism of a republic. The difference? Simply stated, democracy is a majority rule. So, if 51% of the people get what they want, then 49% of the people get something they don't want. Democracy is two wolves and a sheep sitting down to discuss dinner plans. Whereas a republic form of government, which is guaranteed by the Constitution, is well-armed sheep. What did the Founding Fathers think of democracy? The word democracy does not ever appear in the Declaration of Independence, nor in the Constitution. It also never appears in any of the 50 state constitutions. In short, we are not supposed to be a democracy. The Founding Fathers actually did everything they could to keep our new country out of a democracy, knowing that a democracy is just a patriotic word for an oligarchy. Here's what some of the Founding Fathers had to say about a democracy. Quote, "Democracies have ever been spectacles of turbulence and contention, have ever been found incompatible with personal security or the rights of property, and have in general been as short in their lives as they have been violent in their deaths." Unquote. James Madison, the father of the Constitution, from the Federalist Papers, Essay Number 10. Quote, "We are a republican government. Real liberty is never found in the despotism or the extremes of democracy." Unquote. Alexander Hamilton. Quote, "Democracy never lasts long. It soon wastes, exhausts, and murders itself." Unquote. Samuel Adams. Many people, in studying the Constitution, overlook the fact that this is true. Many Americans think that the Constitution was the inventor of the democracy, and do not understand that Rome was a republic for 230 years, until 27 BC, at which time it became a democracy, lasting for around 207 years. In other words, Rome was a democracy as it fell in 180 AD, as all historically significant democratic empires have. Now, politicians and corporations will denounce this, ridiculously proclaiming that we have a democratic republic. But in truth, the two concepts are too opposite from each other to be used to describe each other. This would be like describing a color as blackish white, knowing that black and white are on opposite sides of the entire spectrum of colors. This is because a majority rule can never represent the minority need, nor the minority of one, as in a true republic like the one described in the Constitution. The Bill of Rights are God-given. They are not privileges to be suffocated and chiseled away by legalities and statutes forced upon the public by corporate government weasels in fancy suits, ties, and black robes. Government-owned corporations were never intended to be the police, the treasury, the municipalities or cities, the army, or the appointed legislators. But this is what we have become, a democracy. A better title would be an oligarchic corporocracy or fascism. Corporations owned through a collective investment by the government, whom advertise popular candidates like Obama, knowing that once he is elected, he will appoint former, current, and future corporation lobbyists and attorneys, CEOs, and board members into positions favorable to private corporate government no-bid contracts, thus ensuring future revenue generation for the government-owned corporations while generating wealth and kickbacks for the corporate representatives that are appointed by the elected official, namely the President of the United States Corporation, U.S. Inc. Remember, by electing one person as president, you are giving permission to that person to appoint hundreds and hundreds of unelected officials, who then also appoint unelected officials under themselves, and thousands of appointed corporate power brokers with fancy titles like Secretary of State, Chief of Staff, and Secretary of Defense. The point here is this. You do not have a representative government. End of story. For representation requires the majority vote of the public. But in reality, barely 50% of the American population even get out to vote. Therefore, without a 100% vote, our representatives are illegitimate, for there is no way for them to get approval in the form of a vote from 50% of the people when barely 50% of the people vote. Thus, when we hear our politicians and media hounds constantly harping about bringing democracy to the rest of the world, what this really means is that the United States Incorporated wants to expand its business base internationally, be it oil in Iraq, poppy seeds in Afghanistan, water and mineral rights in South America, or simply the power to use our corporate and United Nations-controlled military to destroy a country's infrastructure so that companies like Halliburton can receive billions in taxpayer money to rebuild what U.S. Inc. destroys. All of this in the name of democracy. Liberal corporatism began to gain adherence in the United States in the late 19th century. Liberal corporatism was an influential component of the progressivism in the United States that has been referred to as interest group liberalism. Fascism's theory of economic corporatism involved the management of sectors of the economy via government or privately controlled organizations, corporations. Each trade union or employer corporation would, in theory, represent its professional concerns, especially through negotiation of labor contracts and the like. This approach, it was theorized, could result in harmony amongst social classes. Authors have noted, however, that de facto economic corporatism was used in specific instances of silencing opposition and rewarding political loyalty. What is corporate governance? It is the set of processes, customs, policies, laws, and institutions affecting the way a corporation or company is directed, administered, or controlled. Corporate governance also includes the relationships among the many stakeholders involved and the goals for which the corporation is governed. The principal stakeholders are the shareholders, the board of directors, employees, customers, creditors, suppliers, and the community at large. Understand, though, that the main goal of a corporation is to make money or make a profit for its shareholders. Oh, and for Mr. Walker, parties involved in corporate governments include the regulatory body, for example, the chief executive officer, the board of directors, management, shareholders, and, auditors, which makes the former comptroller general not ignorant, but an accomplice to crime. Other stakeholders who take part include suppliers, employers, creditors, customers, and the community at large. Now, also very important to understand is the next sentence, which states, "In corporations, the shareholder delegates decision rights to the manager to act in the principal's best interests." Now, let's take a look at the definition of a corporation. A corporation is an institution that is granted a charter recognizing it as a separate legal entity, having its own privileges and liabilities distinct from those of its members. There are many different forms of corporations, most of which are used to conduct business. And for corporate government, business is booming. The word corporation once again derives from corpus, the Latin word for body or a body of people. One type of corporation is called a mutual benefit corporation. A mutual benefit corporation is a corporation formed in the United States solely for the benefit of its members. An example of a mutual benefit corporation is a golf club. Individuals pay to join the club, memberships may be bought and sold, and any property owned by the club is distributed to its members if the club dissolves. The club can decide in its corporate bylaws how many members to have and who can be a member. Corporations can be called clubs, organizations, associations, municipalities, etc., etc. Generally, while it is a non-profit corporation, a mutual benefit corporation is not a charity. If there is a dispute as to how a mutual benefit non-profit corporation is being operated, it is up to the members to resolve the dispute since the corporation exists to solely serve the needs of its membership and not the general public. Very important. In the United States, corporations are created by filling the requisite documents with a particular state government. The process is called incorporation, referring to the abstract concept of clothing the entity with a veil of artificial personhood, embodying or corporating it, corpus being the Latin word for body. Only certain corporations, including banks, are chartered. Once incorporated, the corporation has artificial personhood everywhere it may operate, until such time as the corporation may be dissolved. A corporation that operates in one state while being incorporated in another is a foreign corporation, and we'll talk about that in a moment. A corporation is legally a citizen of the state or other jurisdiction in which it is incorporated. Many large corporations are incorporated in Delaware, for example, without being physically located there because the state has very favorable corporate tax and disclosure laws. As juristic persons, corporations have certain rights that attach to natural persons, in other words, you and me, human beings, natural living beings with a soul. But a corporation has no constitutional right to freely exercise its religion because religious exercise is something that only natural persons can do. That is, only human beings, not business entities, have the necessary faculties of belief and spirituality that enable them to possess and exercise religious beliefs. Once again, because human beings have a soul. And finally, we come to a government-owned corporation. A government-owned corporation, state-owned enterprise, state enterprise, government business enterprise, or peristatal, is a legal entity created by a government to undertake commercial activities on behalf of an owner government. Government-owned corporations can be fully owned or partially owned by government. As a definitional issue, it is difficult to determine categorically what level of state ownership would qualify an entity to be considered as state-owned, since governments can also own regular stock without implying any special interference. As an example, the Chinese Investment Corporation agreed in 2007 to acquire a 9.9% interest in the global investment bank Morgan Stanley. But it is unlikely that this would qualify the latter as a government-owned corporation. Government-owned or state-run enterprises are often the result of corporatization, a process in which government agencies and departments are reorganized as semi-autonomous corporate entities, sometimes with partial shares listed on stock exchanges. The term government-linked company, or GLC, is sometimes used to refer to corporate entities that may be private or public, listed on a stock exchange where an existing government owns a stake using a holding company. There are two main definitions of government-linked companies which are dependent on the proportion of the corporate entity a government owns. One definition purports that a company is classified as a government-linked company if a government owns an effective controlling interest, greater than 50%, while the second definition suggests that any corporate entity that has a government as a shareholder is a government-linked corporation. The problem is, all corporations have the government as a major shareholder. Dow Jones has identified over 100,000 government-owned or controlled corporations in its anti-corruption service. This number far exceeds earlier estimates by the OECD. A quasi-governmental organization, corporation, business, or agency, peristatal, is an entity that is treated by national laws and regulations to be under the guidance of the government, but also separate and autonomous from the government. While the entity may receive some revenue from charging customers for its services, these organizations are often partially or majorly funded by the government. They are usually considered highly important to smooth running of society and are sometimes propped up with cash infusions or bailouts in times of crisis to help surmount situations that would bankrupt a normal, privately owned business. They may also possess law enforcement authority, usually related to their functions. In the United States, the government-sponsored enterprises, or GSEs, are a group of financial services corporations created by the United States Congress. The United States government-sponsored enterprises are private corporations owned by their stockholders, rather than government-owned corporations. Their primary function is to generate profits for their stockholders. But they are structured and regulated by the U.S. government to enhance the availability and reduce the cost of credit to targeted borrowing sectors, agriculture, home finance, and education. Congress created the first government-sponsored enterprise in 1916 with the creation of the Farm Credit System. It initiated government-sponsored enterprises in the home finance segment of the economy with the creation of the Federal Home Loan Banks in 1932. And it targeted education when it chartered Sallie Mae in 1972. Although Congress allowed Sallie Mae to relinquish its government sponsorship and become a fully private institution via legislation in 1995. In other words, a private company bought it after Bush said it was okay. The residential mortgage borrowing segment is by far the largest of the borrowing segments in which the government-sponsored enterprises operate. Together, the three mortgage finance GSEs, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, and the 12 federal home loan banks, have several trillion dollars of on-balance sheet assets. The federal government possesses warrants which, if exercised, would allow them to take a 79.9% ownership share in the companies. Municipal corporations are public corporations that have devolved democratic control over local matters within a geographic region. They are often styled villages, towns, townships, cities, or counties. Though these municipal corporations are often regulated and sometimes financed by the state government, and often can collect taxes, they are arm's-length, non-sovereign, devolved public entities, and a state government which charters them is not legally responsible for their debts in the event of a municipal bankruptcy. So if you have your money invested in a pension fund within a municipality, there is no recourse. You will lose your money in the case of a municipal bankruptcy. Lotteries in the United States are also run by government corporations, such as the Georgia Lottery Corporation and many others. And you wonder why that money never makes it to schools. In an article from January of 2010, the Associated Press writes, "Supreme Court ends limits on corporate campaign spending." The Supreme Court ruled today that corporations may spend as freely as they like to support or oppose candidates for president and Congress, easing decades-old limits on business efforts to influence federal campaigns. The justices also struck down part of the landmark McCain-Feingold campaign finance bill that barred union and corporate paid issue ads in the closing days of election campaigns. Washington. A closely divided Supreme Court on Thursday swept away long-standing limits on campaign spending by unions and corporations. In a long-awaited decision, the court's emboldened conservative majority declared that the limits on so-called independent expenditures by corporations violate First Amendment free speech rights. Remember, corporations are now people, too. The much-anticipated decision means that more money can be spent on federal elections, including this year's congressional elections. This means that corporations now have the same rights as you or me. So what does this precedent, set by the Supreme Court, have to do with taxpayer money? To get the answer to this, let's take a look at the Sunshine Review. Here we have Delaware taxpayer-funded lobbying. Taxpayer-funded lobbying is the practice of engaging in lobbying activities as a public entity. This is done by counties, cities, school districts, public facilities, and many other entities that receive taxpayer money through public funds. This is controversial because the agenda being lobbied for are not decided by taxpayers, whose money is used for the practice. This means the outcomes of lobbying are sometimes opposed to the constituents' benefit. In other words, taxpayer-funded lobbying is not in the interest of the voting, tax-paying public. But let's take a look at another state's taxpayer-funded lobbying. California has the same definition for taxpayer-funded lobbying, meaning that the outcomes of such lobbying are sometimes opposed to the constituents' or taxpayers' benefit. Lobbying the federal government by state and local entities totaled $84.2 million that year. This is the money that's being donated to campaigns. This is the money that's paying for votes. This is the money that is paying for politicians. When we go to California taxpayer-funded lobbying on the Sunshine Review, here we have a list of taxpayer-funded lobbying associations. Remember, an association is a corporation. The following is a list of California taxpayer-funded lobbying associations by type. Here we see lobby after lobby for employees of government-related jobs. Los Angeles Municipal Accountants and Auditors Association, County Elections Officials. Why election officials would have to have a lobby, I don't fully comprehend. Perhaps they're the ones that accepted bribes to get the riggable Diebold electronic voting machines in place for California elections. San Diego County Employees Retirement Association. The list goes on and on. California Association of Highway Patrolmen, California Professional Firefighters, Law Enforcement, Police Officers, California Attorneys, Administrative Law Judges, and Hearing Officers in State Employment. Why do these people need a lobby? Association of California School Administrators, Association of Low Wealth Schools, Retired Teachers, Federation of Teachers, School Boards Association, School Employees Association. It goes on and on. Association of Joint Powers Authorities, Local Agency Formation Commissions, Professional Scientists, Sanitation Agencies. Why do trash men need a lobby? I mean, really, do trash men need taxpayer money to have a lobby so that they can ask the government for something? It doesn't make sense. California Fish and Game Warden Supervisors and Managers Association. Public Parking Association. Remember, public parking has become a privatized corporation. So your taxpayer money is going to a private company to lobby the federal government in order to make their life as a private corporation acting in lieu of a public office a lot easier. California State Park Rangers Association. Mosquito and Vector Control Association of California? What can these people possibly be lobbying the federal government for, let alone the state government? They're mosquito people. They study bugs. Peace Officers Research Association of California. All of this receiving taxpayer money. Air Pollution Control Officers, Association for Alcohol Drug Educators. Here's one, Association for the Gifted. Association of Area Agencies on Aging. Private Special Education Schools, Private Post-Secondary Schools, School Business Officials, School Counselors, School Psychologists, School Transportation Officials, Suburban School Districts, Teachers of English to Speakers of Other Languages. We have a lobby for people who speak English to people who can't speak English. Taxpayer money, folks. Taxpayer money going to these. National Emergency Number Association. It just goes on and on. Then we get into the red. We get into Mental Health Directors Association, Narcotic Officers, Peace Officers, Police Chiefs, Probation, Parole, and Correctional Association, Sexual Assault Investigators Association. What are these things? Sheriff's Association, Coroner's Association, Los Angeles County Police Chiefs, United Teachers of Los Angeles, and the Western Association of Schools and Colleges. These are the taxpayer-funded lobbies that are donating to political campaigns. And now, because of the previous article we just read, the previous Supreme Court case, they have very few restrictions because, you know what? These associations, as corporations, are people too. Just like you and me. So let's go back to Delaware for a moment. This is the page for Delaware General Corporation Law. The Delaware General Corporation Law, Title 8, Chapter 1 of the Delaware Code, is the statute governing corporate law in the state of Delaware. Delaware is well known as a corporate haven. Over 50% of U.S. publicly traded corporations and 60% of the Fortune 500 companies are incorporated in that state. Now, as we mentioned earlier, a corporation that is incorporated in another state while operating in a different state is a foreign corporation. Delaware has also attracted some major credit card banks because of its relaxed rules regarding interest. Many U.S. states have usury laws limiting the amount of interest a lender can charge. Federal law allows a national bank to import these laws from the state in which its principal office is located. Delaware, amongst others, has relatively relaxed interest laws, so several national banks have decided to locate their principal office in Delaware. National banks are, however, corporations formed under federal law, not Delaware law. But Delaware's lax corporate laws are important because the United States has an important corporate law doctrine called the Internal Affairs Doctrine. Pursuant to this rule, corporations which act in more than one state are subject only to the laws of their state of incorporation with regard to the regulation of the internal affairs of the corporation. As a result, Delaware corporations are subject almost exclusively to Delaware law, even when they do business in many or even all 50 states. While most states require a for-profit corporation to have at least one director and two officers, Delaware laws do not have this restriction. All offices may be held by a single person who also can be the sole shareholder. The person, who does not need to be a U.S. citizen or resident, may also operate anonymously. Now you know why most corporations incorporate within the state of Delaware, and then are not held accountable for operating outside of another state's laws. It is also very appealing that these corporations do not have to pay income tax while operating within the state of Delaware. And now we come to the most important part of the puzzle. From this point forward, we'll examine in great detail the shell game that is played with taxpayer money, and we'll look at the difference between the taxpayer budget and the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. The Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, or CAFR, is the general accounting structure for government, a full disclosure of all assets and liabilities. As for the taxpayer budget, which is in the red almost every year, as our politicians promise that they've spent more than they've collected, our collective taxes as citizens of the city, county, state, and country of the United States are raised indiscriminately without regard to the financial hardships it causes. But what we must understand is that the taxpayer budget is only a small portion of the government's full financial statement, the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. The taxpayer budget basically only accounts for the taxes collected from you and me, and the expenditures that the government uses that taxpayer money for within the year. Of course, as an excuse to continuously raise taxes year to year, we find that the thousands and thousands of individual governments throughout the states and the nation always spend more money than they take in. And for the most part, this taxpayer budget is an honest accounting of tax money expenditures. But what is not talked about openly in the media or in any candid public disclosure of note is the financial investments, assets, and holdings of each of the over 185,000 individual governments, municipalities, states, counties, cities, townships, city councils, school districts, enterprise operations, pension funds, and other governmental corporations have in their possession, which are listed on the full financial statement. This is called the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, the CAFR. As alluded to by the former Comptroller General, Mr. David Walker, this report is mandated by federal law to be filed by all of these thousands of governmental corporate structures. But in truth, the CAFR is literally the Achilles heel of the United States government, U.S. Inc. For if the general public were to ever comprehend what is written within these comprehensive financial reports, there would be a revolution by next week. The Comprehensive Annual Financial Report is the true accounting of government investment and wealth, and it is hiding in plain sight. So let's take a look at some of these financial statements from around the country. They are not hard to find. Simply typing the name of your corporation, your city, county, or state government into a search engine, followed by the words Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, or CAFR, will bring up several different years of these financial statements. When considered collectively, we find that through these stock investments, collective government has controlling interest in all Fortune 500 companies and most other major corporations in and outside of the United States. I'm about to show you just how true this really is by looking at these financial statements and reading aloud the government's own words. Mr. Walker was quite right when he said that nobody wants to read these reports due to their lengthy and hard-to-understand facts and figures presented within their often hundreds of pages. But unfortunately for Mr. Walker, I am not nobody. I am a free and natural person who is about to blow the whistle on a bunch of obviously corrupt and evil artificial corporate persons. You see, I don't really care what the corporate-sponsored Supreme Court has to say about the humanistic qualities of corporations, because it was the Supreme Court who ruled in favor of granting the right to patent life itself to these government investment-held corporations. And with more than 40% of the genes in my own body now patented by major multinational corporations, with genetically modified seeds and breast cancer now patented by Monsanto, and with the patenting of the very lifeblood that is drawn from our bodies and used in corporate pharmaceutical research, it is time to declare our freedom from this corporatist government before they patent our very souls. So let's take a look at some of these comprehensive annual financial reports. Let's go back to Delaware. Here on the Sunshine Review, we see the Delaware state budget for 2008 and 2009. Now remember, this is the taxpayer budget. It says, Delaware faced an $84 million budget gap for fiscal year 2009 as of February 2009. For fiscal year 2010, the budget gap was estimated to widen to $606 million. However, more recent reports place the fiscal year 2010 gap closer to $750 million. Amazingly, when we look at the budget figures, which shows general fund expenditures for fiscal years 2003 through 2008, we see that the tiny state of Delaware has increased its expenditures from $2.4 billion to $3.4 billion. And so in a 5 to 6 year period, the state of Delaware increased its spending by $1 billion? When we go to the section called Budget Transparency, it states that Delaware currently has no statewide official spending database online, despite multiple recent attempts to pass legislation which would require such transparency. So you must ask yourself, if a government is in the public trust and the public interest, how can they not be transparent? It also states that there were 32,600 people unemployed in February of 2009, compared with 17,600 in February 2008. So unemployment has almost doubled in Delaware, while government taxpayer-based spending has increased by $1 billion in the last 5 years. This coming from the state who has over 50% of corporations and over 60% of Fortune 500 corporations incorporated within their state. How can you possibly have any unemployment with that many of the nation's corporations? There ought to be a law. But not to worry, Governor Jack Markell will come to the rescue. Under his proposed actions, it says that the governor has proposed an expansion of gambling that would position the state as a Vegas-style destination. Curing the economy with casinos? In the first year, the sports lottery is estimated to generate $55 million in additional revenue. Additionally, with corporate and income tax increases, program and benefit cuts, and an across-the-board payroll reduction of 8%, Markell told lawmakers his plan would balance next year's budget despite a $751 million revenue hole. Now, before we look at the comprehensive annual financial report, which is the full accounting of all the money that Delaware has, this is just one example of the simplistic graphs that are presented to the public. A citizen's guide to the budget. Here we have the fiscal year 2009 general fund operating budget, tax in, tax out. And in the putting it into perspective graph, the final challenge, we have a nice little snake with little dots showing us how that works. Now, after all of that, let's look at the 2009 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for Delaware for the year ended June 30th, 2009. We won't go through the whole report in this case. However, one page, just one page in this report says it all. On page 29 of 192 pages is the section called Statewide Financial Analysis. It states that, as noted earlier, net assets may serve over time as a useful indicator of a government's financial position. This is referring to all of the investments and holdings that the Delaware state government has been holding for many, many years. It then says that the state's assets exceeded its liabilities by $5,204 million at the close of the most recent fiscal year. I'll say that again. The state's assets exceeded its liabilities by $5,204 million at the close of the most recent fiscal year. These are the investments that are not talked about on the budget report. Again, we are looking at the comprehensive, meaning full, everything, all assets and holdings. The state's assets exceeded its liabilities by $5,204 million. It then goes on to state that the largest portion of the state's net assets, 84.4%, reflects its investment in capital assets. For example, land, buildings, vehicles, and equipment, less any related outstanding debt used to acquire those assets. And at last, it states, restricted net assets, comprising 7.5% of total net assets, represents resources that are subject to external restrictions, constitutional provisions, or enabling legislation on how they can be used. In other words, it's monies invested that cannot be liquidated. The remaining portion, unrestricted net assets, at 8.1%, may be used at the state's discretion. However, some of these funds have been appropriated based on state statutes. Now, to translate this, unrestricted net assets that may be used at the state's discretion for whatever the state wants to use it for is 8.1% of $5.2 billion. Now, since I'm sure you don't have a calculator handy, 8.1% of $5,204,700,000 is $421,580,000, which may be used at the state's discretion. Well, that certainly seems to be enough to pay the $84 million budget gap for fiscal year 2009, as reported on the Delaware State Budget. So instead of using this excess $421 million, which is only 8% of total assets for fiscal year 2009 in Delaware, the governor's recommendation for the incoming governor is to trim education by another $36.4 million, plus a 3% cut to higher education, plus an 8% pay cut for state employees and the raising of taxes for residents who make more than $60,000 a year. This is the criminal extortion racket called government. This is just one example of hidden assets and expendable monies that are being used for shareholder profit instead of the fiscally responsible actions of supporting the populace of the state of Delaware. But you must remember that this is only the comprehensive annual financial report for the state government of Delaware. This does not include the hundreds or thousands of individual city, county, school district, pension fund, and other governments within the state of Delaware, which all have their own individual comprehensive annual financial reports showing other billions of dollars in investments and other assets. And you ain't seen nothing yet. Let's go on to some other CAFRs from around the country. Moving further south, and still looking at the Sunshine Review, we see here the Florida state budget. It states that Florida state analysts estimate that the state faces a budget deficit for 2011 and 2012 of approximately $2.5 billion, which is down considerably from previous forecast of a $6 to $8 billion shortfall. The Florida State Legislature passed the fiscal year 2011 Florida State budget on April 30, 2010, the deadline for doing so. The fiscal year 2011 budget is $4 billion larger than the prior year's state budget. $4 billion larger in 1 year. The Florida legislature struggled to plug a revenue shortfall of $3.2 billion. The budget leaves $1.4 billion in reserves. That's it, just $1.4 billion. The budget includes an increase in tobacco taxes, $1 per pack of cigarettes, and $900 million by expanding gambling. There seems to be a gambling theme as a way to fix economies. Forget producing anything, let's just have casinos. Under budget status for 2008-2009, It states, as early as November of 2006, Florida had the second most foreclosures in the country, with 95,862 homes foreclosed upon in just the third quarter of that year. The Florida foreclosure rate remains 1 in 214 homes. In addition to the far-reaching effects of the mortgage crisis, Florida faces long-term budget problems as a result of a decline in its major economic engines, building, migration, and tourism, which have all declined. State revenue has declined for 3 years in a row, and the new fiscal year beginning July 1, 2009, could be the fourth. With the fall in property taxes, school districts remain underfunded. Also, Florida does not have an income tax. It relies heavily on sales tax, corporate tax, and real estate transaction taxes, which have all declined. Perhaps that's because all of the corporations moved to Delaware. Florida has a thing called the 2008 Deficit Elimination Package. The plan included increases in traffic fines of $10 for every traffic ticket issued except for speeding tickets, which went up by $25, and an elimination of 18% discount tickets for those enrolled in driver improvement courses. A suspension in the Environmental Land Program, saving $4 million and canceling $250 million in bond sales. A 10.5% cut in Medicaid payments to nursing homes, and a tax increase on nursing homes. A transfer of $400 million from a rainy day fund, leaving about $250 million in the fund. A $466 million cut in education spending, an option for school administrators to volunteer for pay cuts, and limiting the severance of teachers and administrations to 1 year. A 2% decrease in teachers' bonuses, saving the state $11 million. A 4% cut in aid to state universities and community colleges for a savings of $157 million. $700 million to be borrowed from a $1.2 billion endowment that invests money from tobacco settlements for future use on health care programs. A $9.9 million cut in the state public-private tourism agency, Visit Florida. A 5% cut in a program that helps people with developmental disabilities, including autism. But I'll bet they're still supporting vaccines. A $190 million cut in a program that helps pay for low and moderate income housing. An elimination of 1,400 state jobs. And a $3.7 million decrease in funding for cancer, cardiovascular, stroke, and pulmonary diseases. Yet not one mention of wasteful government spending. The Honorable Charlie Crist, the governor of Florida, in his policy and budget recommendations for fiscal year 2010 and 11, had these budget highlights. Keeping Florida's economy vibrant. Investing in Florida's workforce and infrastructure. Continuing Florida's educational excellence. Strengthening Florida's families, keeping Floridians healthy, preserving Florida's natural resources for generations to come, and protecting communities and preserving peace of mind. Now, how do you keep Florida's economy vibrant when you're laying off state workers? How do you invest in Florida's workforce and infrastructure when you're selling it off? How do you continue Florida's educational excellence when you're cutting off school funds? How do you strengthen Florida's families and keep Floridians healthy when you're cutting off Medicare payments and research for cancer and cardiovascular diseases? And how do you protect communities and preserve peace of mind when you are robbing your constituents blind with your hidden wealth and investments? Now, this is quite reminiscent of Barack Obama's Hope and Change campaign. But you cannot legislate hope. And you cannot hope for change without a representative government. Now, in Florida's case, I decided to pull up not the actual comprehensive annual financial report, which would have just told you how much money it actually had, but in this case, Florida is one of the exceptional states that actually lists out its investment holdings in a long list. So, starting at page 1 of 1,479 pages of assets and investments held by the Florida state government, as listed in the Florida 2009 State Investment Holdings Report, the first page states, per the PFIA legislation, only publicly traded securities are included in this report. Privately held securities are not. So the following are just the investments that the state of Florida, the one individual government called the Florida State Government, with its own individual CAFR, these are its investments in publicly traded companies. Now, I'm just going to go through pages of investments and read you some of the companies that you might recognize. Starting on page 101, we see that as of June 30th, 2010, the corporate government of the state of Florida owns 558,771,266 worth of Johnson & Johnson stock. Here they have AT&T stock, $504.5 million. Here's Apple Computers, or Apple Incorporated, at $773.8 million in stock investments. Here's one that'll blow your mind. This is in the cash and temporary holdings category. Listed under other, this is cash holdings, and it is listed at $6.7 billion. That right there is enough to pay off the budget crisis that Florida states that it has, just with this extra little bit of cash that it lists in its comprehensive annual financial report, the state investment holdings for 2009. Not to mention all these other investments that are scattered throughout these 1,479 pages. Also in cash and temporary, we have holdings in Japan. It doesn't really list what it is. It just says it's $39 million. Maybe it's yen. Back to stock investments, we have Abbott Laboratories, which is a pharmaceutical, at $210.8 million. For you World of Warcraft fans, Florida holds $17 million in stock investments in Activision and Blizzard, the company that makes your favorite game. Isn't it ironic that the very regulatory body that's supposed to rate video games for violence is the same government that has massive investments in the video game industry? Here's Adidas, the shoe and clothing company out of Germany, at $68.5 million. Advanced Auto Parts, an automotive retail chain, at $22.6 billion. How about Aetna? Managed healthcare at $49,685,000. African Bank Investments in South Africa, $16.3 million. Hey, why not? Gotta diversify, huh? Are you starting to understand that just a small amount of the money that governments have invested in corporations and foreign corporations could easily pay off the entire country's debt, let alone the state of Florida's? Here's a big one. Here's the Sony Corporation, listed under electronic appliances, at $29.4 million. Sprint Nextel, wireless telecommunications services, at $34.4 million. St. Jude Medical, a healthcare equipment provider, at $35.7 million. Staples Incorporated, specialty stores, at $65.6 million. Stanley Black & Decker Household Appliances at $24.8 million. State Street Corporation, listed as Asset Management and Custody Banks, at $55 million. Here's the State Bank of India, for a total of $18.5 million. Suzuki Motor Company, Land Transportation, at $20.2 million. Swatch Group, the famous watchmakers of Switzerland, $21.7 million. Now you can see how strongly vested the state of Florida is in just about every possible industry and sub-industry in existence. I mean, look at these lists. Most of these are in the tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, and a lot of them are in the millions. We even saw some that are in the billions. This is the money that the government called the state of Florida, the corporation acting as the government of Florida, has been earning off the taxpayer money it collects from you, invests, and then never gives you, the taxpayer, any of the profits. Ah, there's Target, general merchandise store, listed at over $114 million. There's Texas Instruments, listed as semiconductors at $94.8 million. Verizon Communications Integrated Telecommunication Services, again, at $261 million worth of stock investments. Now again, this is only the state government of Florida. This does not include each individual government within the state who has its own comprehensive annual financial report showing all of these types of investments. And may I just say, David Walker should be arrested right now for treason against the American people. Right now. Now remember, these are all publicly traded companies, and this list is not including private companies for which the Florida state government has invested in. Here's Viacom, movies and entertainment. Very important to control the entertainment and propaganda industry at $65.4 million. Now some of you might be thinking, why haven't I heard about this on the news? Surely if this was true, Glenn Beck would be talking about it. But for a $50 million contract, you'd probably sell your soul to the devil as well. Once again, when adding collective government investments into Fortune 500 companies, which includes the five or six major conglomerate media companies that own just about every major media outlet available to you, the control of information is vital in a crime such as this. Here's Visa Incorporated. We all unfortunately know what Visa is, and that appears to be a total of about $145 million. Here's Walmart Stores Incorporated. Oh, we all love the Walmart, at about $318 million. Wells Fargo. Well, look at there. Florida owns a major stake in my bank. $413.4 million. Here's Yahoo. Internet software and services at $50 million. 3M, industrial conglomerates, they make just about everything involving plastic, at $192.3 million. Here's American Express, another banking and finance investment at $175 million. Now, keep in mind, we've just reached page 400, and I was skipping many pages and many companies in between. And we've still got so many to go. But just to make sure that you have the full perspective of what you've just looked at here, for each individual page for which you've just looked at, there are a total of 40 investments. 40 investments times 400 pages is 16,000 different investments in just one-fifth of the Florida state CAFR. I think that you get the idea that Florida has money coming out of its butt, but it's not telling the people of Florida. Instead, it's cutting jobs, cutting public funding, and raising your taxes. On page 652, we see fixed income investments in the banking and finance industry. Here we see that the State Corporation of Florida has investments of a little less than $100 million in Goldman Sachs Group. They have about $26 million in Merrill Lynch, which I believe got sold off to Bank of America not too long ago. Again, a fire sale where assets are sold for pennies on the dollar, while liabilities are nationalized or divided amongst taxpayers. We have about $35 million in Morgan Stanley and about $35 million in Wells Fargo. On page 677, we see that Florida's combined holdings in just its SP funds are about $21 billion. Now, to give you an idea of how Florida has not put all of its eggs in one basket, let's take a look at how diversified its investments are within different industries. We have oil and gas equipment services, multi-utilities, electric utilities, investment banking and brokerage houses, land transportation, regional banks, diversified chemicals, industrial machinery, internet software and services, communications equipment, education services, pharmaceuticals, electric power and gas, electric appliances, healthcare services, food retail. And of course, you can't invest in oil and gas without having some place to store and transport it. And of course, before you store and transport it, you have to have oil and gas exploration and production, reinsurance as well as regular insurance, and of course, household products. Now, this is just the diversification of one page of all of these investments. So imagine how invested the Corporation of Florida really is. Likewise, you can't just invest in one currency. Therefore, the State Corporation of Florida has invested in many, many different countries, including Australia, Brazil, Canada, the Czech Republic, Denmark, the United States, of course, the European Union, through the euro, commercial paper, which probably amounts to junk bonds, China, Hungary, Israel, Japan, Malaysia, Mexico, Morocco, New Zealand, Norway, Peru, the Philippines, Poland, Singapore, South Africa, and South Korea. And of course, we can't forget the superb bankers of Switzerland, Taiwan, Thailand, Turkey, the Queen in the United Kingdom, Germany, Malaysia, Belgium, France, Portugal, Argentina, and even Jordan. And of course, if you're going to invest in a specific industry, you don't want to put all your eggs in just one company. So let's just take the healthcare and pharmaceutical industry and see who Florida has invested in. Here we have Astellas Pharmaceuticals, and of course AstraZeneca, ooh, that's a big one at $3.4 million, Abbott Laboratories, Allergan Incorporated Pharmaceuticals, Baxter International Healthcare Equipment, Bayer AG out of Germany. Now, of course, Bayer broke off from the Nazi conglomerate company IG Farben, which supported the Nazi war effort in Germany during World War II. We have BioVail Corporation of Pharmaceuticals, Beckman Coulter Healthcare Equipment, Boston Scientific Healthcare Equipment, Bristol-Myers Squibb Pharmaceuticals, Brookdale Senior Living Incorporated under Healthcare Facilities. We could call that Death Care Facilities, though. Cardinal Health Incorporated, a healthcare distributor, and Care Fusion Corporation, healthcare equipment. Chugai Pharmaceuticals, Signacorp Managed Healthcare, Community Health Systems Healthcare Facilities, Cooper COS Incorporated, which is healthcare supplies, Coventry Healthcare Incorporated, again managed healthcare, Danapon Sumitomo Pharmaceuticals, Daiichi Sankyo Pharmaceuticals, Endion Incorporated Healthcare Services, Aisei Pharmaceuticals, and of course Eli Lilly and Company Pharmaceuticals. Now these were just the pharmaceutical and healthcare companies for the letters A through E. So what's the big deal? What's wrong with pharmaceutical and healthcare industry investments? Well, I'm glad I asked. The recently passed H.R. 3590, Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, you know, the infamous healthcare bill that passed without our legislators even reading its thousands of pages before voting to approve it? This one bill signed by our good President Obama will guarantee that pharmaceutical and healthcare insurance corporations receive many trillions of dollars in research and development and other taxpayer grants and giveaways. Therefore, investing in these pharmaceuticals is all but a sure thing, meaning that the fund balances and returns on government pension and other funds will go up, 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 while quality of care goes down into the gutter. This is just one step away from insider trading. But I'm sure that the government won't be prosecuting its own branch government for manipulating the market that it manipulates through insane House resolutions like the Obamacare bill. These are two peas in a pod. Moving on. Interestingly, we see that the state of Florida has investments in the corporate state of Oregon. Here in cash and temporary funds, under the Dreyfus Government Cash Management Fund, in U.S. cash, the state of Florida has $2.3 million. In the Fixed Income Federal National Management Association, under Agencies and Other Government Obligations, we have about $5.1 million. And for those of you like me who always thought that scholarship funds were set up by someone who just cared about education, think again. Here we see one of the Florida State Scholarship Funds, the Agnes Peebles Scholarship Fund, to be exact. Here it states the market value of stocks held in the scholarship fund. We have AT&T, Comcast, LSI Logic, Merck Pharmaceuticals, Quest, Verizon, Bell Atlantic, Vodafone, and Fairpoint Communications. I'll be told this scholarship fund has over $2 million in investments. And that is profit, which is probably never going to be seen by any student. Now, also listed on this scholarship fund is the class of stock. Notice that some is Class A stock, some is Class B stock, and some have both. Let's pause for a moment and really get a grasp on what stock actually is. Back to Wikipedia, we see that under the page named Stock, and in the subsection Shares, it states that shares represent a fraction of ownership in a business. Pretty simple. If you own stock in a business, you have partial ownership in that business. And as collective government, who has partial ownership in over 185,000 different governments, you can start to understand how much of these corporations the collective government owns. A business may declare different types or classes of shares, each having distinctive ownership rules, privileges, or share values. Under the Types of Stock section, it states, stock typically takes the form of shares of either common stock or preferred stock. As a unit of ownership, common stock typically carries voting rights that can be exercised in corporate decisions. Very important. Preferred stock differs from common stock in that it typically does not carry voting rights, but is legally entitled to receive a certain level of dividend payments before any dividends can be issued to other shareholders. Preferred stock may be hybrid by having the qualities of bonds of fixed returns and common stock voting rights, however. They also have preference in the payment of dividends over common stock and also have been given preference at the time of liquidation over common stock. Under the shareholder section, it states, a shareholder or stockholder is an individual or company, including a corporation, that legally owns one or more shares of stock in a joint stock company. Both private and public traded companies have shareholders. Companies listed at the stock market are expected to strive to enhance shareholder value. Once again, the people are left in the cold. Shareholders are granted special privileges depending on the class of stock, including the right to vote on matters such as elections to the board of directors, the right to share in distributions of company's income, the right to purchase new shares issued by the company, and the right to a company's assets during a liquidation of the company. However, shareholders' rights to a company's assets are subordinate to the rights of the company's creditors. Now, once again here, we are touching on the subject of collective government, all of the 185,000-plus different corporations acting as governments, having voting rights in all of these publicly traded and private corporations on matters related to the board of directors. What this really means is that the government, through all of its collective investment holdings, through all of these governments, has proxy rights to replace the board of directors because that collective government has controlling stock in these corporations and actually place who they want into these seats as directors of the company. Therefore, the government not only has controlling interest through stock investment, Class A and B, into these companies, but collectively, government also calls the shots. And worst of all, government is the regulator of government-owned corporations. Under the section Shareholder Rights, it states that although ownership of 50% of shares does result in 50% ownership of a company, it does not give the shareholder the right to use a company's building, equipment, materials, or other property. This is because the company is considered a legal person. Once again, corporations are people too. Thus, it owns all its assets itself. However, in most countries, boards of directors and company managers have a fiduciary responsibility to run the company in the interests of the stockholders. If the majority stockholder in every case is collective government, and the government elects the board of directors, who then have a fiduciary responsibility to run the company in the interest of its stockholders, or the government, you see the vicious circle that is happening here. This is corporate governance. This is corporate fascism. Even though the board of directors runs the company, the shareholder has some impact on the company's policy, as the shareholders elect the board of directors. Each shareholder typically has a percentage of votes equal to the percentage of shares he or she owns. Now, one of the differences between Class A and Class B stock will be the amount of votes attached to that stock. For instance, the initial Class A stock might have 20 to 50 votes attached to it, whereas a Class B stock available on the open market might only have one vote. So as long as the shareholders agree that the management or agent are performing poorly, they can elect a new board of directors, which can then hire a new management team. So government, just as it didn't like Saddam Hussein, can go in and replace the CEO of the company through the board of directors by proxy vote. Board candidates are usually nominated by insiders or by the board of directors themselves, and a considerable amount of stock is held or voted by insiders. Now, after looking at just Florida's state comprehensive annual financial report, and then considering all of the other governments around the country, it's pretty obvious who has controlling stock in these corporations. Collective government. Also very interesting, on page 666, we see that the state corporation called Florida has major investments in Torrey Pines Golf Course, which is located in San Diego, California, altogether about $12 million worth. Now, when we go to the TorreyPinesGolfCourse.com website, we read the following. The city of San Diego is the owner and operator of the Torrey Pines Golf Courses and owner of the registered mark Torrey Pines, which is used under license by Torrey Pines Club Corporation. This is a government-owned enterprise operation. Now, I don't have to tell you that if you add up these over 1,400 pages of investments, cash holdings, and other assets of the state government of Florida, the budget deficit of the entire world could probably be paid off. So the next time you hear your local politician, city council member, senator, or congressman in the state of Florida tell you that we're in a budget crisis, you call him or her out on their lie. And hey, if they say they don't know about this, then you ask them why they don't know about the General Accounting System for Government. That would be like a Baptist minister not knowing what the Bible is. So let's take a little trip over to the West Coast and look at the 2000 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for the California State Teachers Retirement System. Now again, this is a government corporation, stating that CalSTRS is a component unit of the state of California. Of course, this report is only 90 pages long, as it does not list each individual investment and asset separately. So in this CAFR, we're only going to be looking at totals. We begin with the California State Teachers Retirement System combined statements of plan net assets as of June 30th, 2000. Now keep in mind that this is reported in the thousands, meaning that you must add three zeros to each figure presented. Now in the column marked State Teachers Retirement Plan and Assets, it states that investments at fair value for the short term equate to $1,559,699,000. Under debt securities, domestically, meaning in the United States, CalSTRS is holding $27,236,000,000, and internationally, $22,000. In equities domestically, CalSTRS is holding $46,691,549,000. In international equities, stock, and other investments, CalSTRS is holding $26,956,087,000. Alternative, I'm not sure what that refers to, $5,105,654,000. Real estate holdings equate to $3,771,458,000. And finally, securities lending collateral at $16,107,099,000. So total investments equal over $127 billion. But wait, that's not the end. For CalSTRS is apparently in possession of some petty cash at $3,234,000. And in accounts receivable for the year 2000, it appears that we have $1,941,810 for investments sold. Foreign currency exchange contracts equate to $1,991,213,000. Interest and dividends that it receives from all these investments, $475,596,000. And then member and employer and other receivables at $406,698,000. And so we add total receivables of $4,815,317,000 plus another $338,000 worth of other assets for total CalSTRS assets listed at over $132 billion for the year 2000. Ah, but wait, there are some liabilities. They still owe approximately $1,116,000,000 for investments that they've purchased. And on some foreign currency exchange contracts, they still owe $1,976,000,000. They are paying a certain amount of benefits at $69,959,000. Some other liabilities at $195,000,000 and securities lending collateral at $16,107,000,000. For total liabilities of $19,464,769,000. Comparatively, net assets held in trust for pension benefits by the state corporation called CalSTRS equals $112,781,688,000. Now just look at the liabilities compared to the assets, a difference of almost $100 billion. Now, of course, you'll say, well, it's in the trust. It's all going to go to the teachers. They need that for their retirement. It's perfectly legitimate. Well, let's just take a look at what actually happens each year in this pension fund. Here it shows that total contributions from its hundreds of thousands of members equal $4,062,503,000. Now, this represents the money available outside of what we just saw to pay benefits due to California retired teachers and employees. Now, under the deductions category, we see that actual benefits paid to the CalSTRS employees for retirement are as follows. Retirement, death, and survivor benefits at $3,435,268,000. Refunds of member contributions at $80 million. Purchasing power benefits at $190 million. And administrative expenses at $50,500,000. With total deductions at $3,756,292,000. Now that is what CalSTRS is paying out to its members who are drawing from the pension fund. Which means that the CalSTRS pension fund made a $12,996,961,000 profit for the year 2000. And for 1999, an $11,596,346,000 profit. Required member and employer contribution rates are set by the teacher's retirement law. Required contribution rates are expressed as a level percentage of entry age normal actuarial cost method. The system also uses the level percentage of payroll method to calculate the amortization of any unfunded liability. A summary of statutory rates and other sources of contributions to the system is as follows. Members are forced by law to pay 8% of applicable member earnings, while employers are forced to pay 8.25% of applicable member earnings. In other words, they match employee contributions plus 0.25%. Now, on page 27, under Notes to General Purpose Financial Statements, it states under Foreign Currency Exchange Contracts that the State Teacher Retirement Plan enters into forward foreign currency exchange contracts for hedging purposes to minimize the short-term impact of foreign currency fluctuations on the asset positions of foreign investments. The State Teacher's Retirement Plan could be exposed to risk if the counterparties to the contracts are unable to meet the terms of their contracts. The STRP seeks to minimize risk from counterparties by establishing minimum credit quality standards and maximum credit limits. In other words, the California State Teacher's Retirement System is acting as a bank, lending and investing money into other corporate structures, both nationally and internationally. And then under the income taxes section, it states, the State Teacher Retirement Program is organized as a tax-exempt retirement plan under the IRC. The 403B program is organized as a tax-deferred supplemental program under the IRC. The system's management believes that it is operated within the constraints imposed by federal tax law. But when the law becomes lawless and not in the interest of its members or the taxpayers of the union, we have a problem. And on page 29, it states, state statutes and teachers' retirement board policies permit the STRP to lend its securities to broker-dealers and other entities for which collateral is received with a simultaneous agreement to return the collateral for the same securities in the future. Once again, the STRP acting as a bank. STRP has contracted with third-party securities lending agents to lend domestic and international equity and debt securities. meaning it's an international corporation. All securities loans can be terminated on demand by either STRP or the borrower. Now, to translate this gobbledygook, let's just consider the members and beneficiaries of the California State Teachers Retirement System as savings account holders. They all hold a savings account together. Now, as in your own personal savings account, the bank, or STRP, is going to give you a measly 1 to 5% return on the money you have in your collective savings account. But the bank, the STRP, is taking that money, investing it elsewhere, putting it at possibly great risk, making a 10, 20, 30% return on that investment, but never adding to the measly 3% that you get on your return for allowing the bank to risk and make a huge profit off of your savings. This has been happening for over 70 years, since before the Comprehensive Annual Financial Reporting System was even put into place. Now here's a look at just the schedule of administrative expenses for the year ended June 30th, 2000. In order to keep all of these funds, numbers, assets, and deductions straight, the California State Teachers Retirement System pays the State Street Bank administrative fees of $255,000. Chart A shows growth in total investments in millions, meaning we add six zeros. In 1985, the chart shows $14,208,000,000 in total investments. And as we see, the chart goes continuously up and up and up until finally we reach the June 2000 total of $112,640,000,000. And this chart is reminiscent of most pension funds across the country. Now, on page 43, Chart B shows CalSTRS returns against the actuarial rate, which is the long-term assumed rate of return. So this is just a pie chart of the growth in CalSTRS returns. But what you must understand is that, proudly, these are the returns on investments above and beyond what is required to pay state employees and pensioners. This is a business, a profitable business. This graph shows the actuarial rate, meaning the stated rate of return on the money that the California State school employees need to acquire in order to have their retirement. Anything above this black line is profit. And here we see just how wonderful these guys are at investing other people's money. Over a 5-year period, we can see that the total gains, and notice there are no losses, the total gains equal 14.72% over 5 years. Now again, CalSTRS has essentially become a bank. It states the fixed income unit also manages three other programs: the home loan program, the currency hedging program, and the securities lending program. So if you're a state school employee in California, your money is being lended elsewhere. Your neighbor may have bought their home with your money. Under the home loan program, it states that legislation that became effective in 1999 broadened CalSTRS's ability to offer home loans with different interest rates, terms, and conditions. Once again, a sign that the regulators and legislatures work together to ensure that these type of funds can do whatever the heck they want. During the last fiscal year, CalSTRS funded more than $55 million in home loans, bringing the total since organization in 1986 to nearly $3 billion. So apparently, CalSTRS wants to keep expanding its usurious loan program. Under the currency hedging program, it states that CalSTRS currently hedges a portion of its international stock exposure in order to protect these assets against a strengthening U.S. dollar in both Asia and Europe. It also states that this currency hedging program has been successful in adding value as a result of its prudent use of basic hedging principles and the strength of the U.S. dollar overseas. To date, the currency hedging program has generated more than $450 million in additional income to the fund. Simply stated, this means betting on one currency against another. And my guess would be that these and other funds and government corporations probably know in advance which currencies will get higher and lower, because these government-controlled corporations are the world economy. So naturally, in a huge conflict of interest, they know what's going to happen to the market in the future. And under the securities lending program, it states CalSTRS has been lending securities since 1988, and that this represents CalSTRS' first and longest-running off-balance sheet program. Over the last fiscal year, CalSTRS has earned more than $55 million from this activity. Since inception, the program has earned approximately $350 million. Chart D lists U.S. Treasury bonds that it has purchased at an interest rate of 8.88%, with a market value of $809 million. So that means that in 2017, when these U.S. Treasury bonds mature, the fund will receive a gain on its investment into the U.S. Treasury bonds of $103.7 million. Other funds, which mature in 2020, 2019, 2018, amount to hundreds of millions in unrealized gains. It's also invested in the Federal Home Loan Mortgage Corporation, with a market value of $451.9 million, which just matured last year. It's also invested in the Tennessee Valley Authority, for a market share of $384.4 million. And now we get to perhaps the most important part of this whole presentation. For if you comprehend the following, you will finally understand what corporate governments and government-owned corporations really are. Here on Chart E, CalSTRS lists its largest equity holdings as of June 30, 2000, and it states that just in General Electric stock alone, it holds 28,948,341 shares of General Electric stock, with a market value of $1,534,262,073. That, my friends, is a major market share of General Electric stock. And once again, we must remember that this is just one of over 185,000 different governments in the United States. It also lists Intel Corp with 9.9 million shares, Cisco Systems at 20.5 million shares, Microsoft Corporation at 15.7 million shares, Pfizer Pharmaceuticals Incorporated at 18.6 million shares, ExxonMobil Corporation at 10 million shares, Walmart Stores at 12.8 million shares, Oracle Corporation at 8.6 million shares, Nortel Networks Corporation at 9.2 million shares, and Vodafone AirTouch at 147.8 million shares. And these are just the largest of the stock holdings within CalSTRS. Walter Burian of CalFor1.com has estimated that government ownership of just Microsoft Corporation stock is at approximately 83%, with the five boroughs of New York City proper owning collectively about 5% of that company. This means that everything that you do on your computer and everything that is included in your end-user agreement belongs to the government. And the government is the one regulating the internet. It's also the one regulating advertising, usury, and fraud laws. The conflicts of interest here are astounding. Because remember, the Central Intelligence Agency and the National Security Agency are private government offices with access to everything that you do on the internet and through Microsoft. And Apple computers are also government-owned. Now, Understanding that, we go to page 46, where Calster's actually devoted a paragraph to corporate governance. Now, if you still don't comprehend what a proxy vote means, this is an admission of guilt. It states, during the 1999-2000 fiscal year, Calsters voted on a variety of proxy issues, including financial, corporate governance, and social issues. There were 7,192 votes cast on proxy issues of corporations whose shares were owned in the investment portfolio. These proxy issues were presented on 2,789 companies. The overall number of proxy issues increased from 6,588 last year, but the number of mergers and acquisitions reviewed remained constant, at a little more than 10%. Merger activity, both within United States borders and across the borders, continued its steady course, especially in those transactions where stock is the compensation received by the acquired company's holders. This reflects the continued appreciation in the stock market, both at home and abroad. So this government corporation, one of over 185,000 within the United States, just told us that it voted on a variety of proxy issues, including financial, corporate governance, and social issues, with 7,192 votes cast on proxy issues of corporations whose shares were owned in their investment portfolio. In other words, Calsters is acting as a major shareholder, voting as partial owners of these corporations on issues that dictate the future success of those corporations. This is corporate governance, in the words of the United States government. This is perhaps the most important, revealing paragraph you will ever read in your lifetime. This is fascism. Then, on page 47, Calsters states that by proxy, the major issues voted on are summarized below. And once again, this is criminal activity. And by this point, surely you realize the Constitution is out the window. Number 1, election of directors. Calsters generally votes in favor of directors unless the proxy statement shows circumstances contrary to policy. The selection of auditors and accountants. Calsters generally votes in favor on the independent auditors and accountants recommended by management. And for its employees, under compensation plans, stock options, incentive stock options, employee stock purchase plans, etc. Corporations provide a variety of compensation plans to keep executives, employees, and non-employee directors. A number of these plans provide for the issuance of long-term incentives to attract, reward, and retain key employees, the best of the best of the criminals, and other miscellaneous management. Calsters generally votes in favor of other miscellaneous business recommended by management, but issues are decided on a case-by-case basis. Now, the word management here, when it's recommended by management, simply means that the government, as a collective whole, wants Calsters to vote a certain way with regards to its ownership stock holdings in these corporations. Also, in voting to approve merger acquisition management, Calsters generally votes in favor of the acquisition or merger of one company into another. This means that the Pension Fund for California State Teachers has a say in whether the companies it owns stock in can merge with one another. Number 5 is corporate actions and corporate governance issues. These are issues related to mergers, acquisitions, stock issuance, stock splits, and incorporation. CalSTRS generally votes in favor of these proposals unless there is a compelling reason not to cast a positive vote. Once again, CalSTRS is deciding on mergers, acquisitions, stock issuance, in other words, who gets the stock, and stock splits, which can only serve to benefit CalSTRS. The government is the corporations. The corporations are the government. There is no fine line. That line has been erased. Erased just like our borders and just like our Constitution. Back to page 45, under real estate, it states that over the last fiscal year, CalSTRS portfolio of real estate assets reached $3.8 billion. 82 directly owned properties and 3 privately owned partnerships represented this dollar amount. Real estate represents nearly 3% of the total portfolio. The direct property portfolio is diversified as a property type and geographic location. The largest component of the direct property sector is office. As is true last year, the largest weighting is in the western region of the United States. The CalSTRS real estate portfolio has achieved annual returns of 9, 17, and 14% for the 1, 3, and 5-year periods, respectively. And remember, all of this is happening tax-free. These corporations are exempt from any taxes. On page 46, we have Chart F, which is the investment summary for the year ended June 30th, 2000, again in millions, which shows the net assets and investments. Now, Chart G shows the schedule of fees for July 1, 1999 through June 30th of 2000, and it's listed in thousands. So we can see here where a lot of this profit is going. For just the domestic equity holdings, stock and everything else, CalSTRS is paying $10,261,000 to its equity managers. For international equities, it's paying $31,673,000 to managers. Alternative investments, $1 million, and real estate, $12.8 million, for total investment managers' fees of $55 million. This is ridiculous. $55.94 million in fees. This is corruption at its finest, aged for a very long time until perfectly corrupt. Here's Chart H listing broker commissions for the 1 year period ending June 30th, 2000. Just for domestic commissions for the brokers that handle these equities, CalSTRS is paying $4.8 million just for domestic equities. For international commissions, it's paying almost $11 million. If only this money were being used to benefit the public, or at least the school employees of California. Now, when it comes down to determining the bottom line on what these pension funds will pay out to their members, it is an exact science. This sounds more like we're talking about cattle than people. Between the contributions from its members and the rate of return from just those contributions when invested in the markets, the full amount of money paid to beneficiaries of the CalSTRS pension fund are completely paid. So all of the other net assets held in trust for pension benefits, which in 2000 equated to $112,781,688,000, can be used for something other than paying school employees. In other words, everything that this fund does from the year 2000 on is pure speculation and profit, because the amount of money that is being put into this pension fund by school employees who are mandated by law to contribute to this fund is enough money to pay all retirement benefits for qualified and retired California state teachers. Now just imagine if these people who are working with these funds, investing in and controlling the market, were actually using that money for the good of the taxpayers, for the good of the economy, and to the benefit of humanity. This is exactly what Walter Burian of CAFR1.com would like to see happen. His life dream is simply to see this rightfully taxpayer money be put to use to benefit the taxpayers of America. His tax retirement funds would reacquire this massive store of wealth, get rid of the corruption controlling it through complete transparency, and use that money for the benefit of the people, the states, and the country. Imagine a government actually funding alternative energy solutions that aren't from corporations. Imagine alleviating all federal, state, and local taxes simply by using this government store of investment income to pay all of the taxes that we are forced to pay by law. Imagine freedom without eminent domain and other federal tyrannies to get in the way of true land and home ownership. Imagine a government that actually rewards its legislators for fiscal responsibility instead of theft by deception and usury, for saving money instead of forcibly spending and wasting it to ensure larger budgets for the next quarter. Imagine a work environment where honesty and integrity are the most sought-after qualities for employees, where lying, cheating, and stealing are not rewarded, but instead looked down upon. Imagine actually trusting your politicians without doubt, simply because everything they do is scrutinized and transparent by law, and they know they will lose their position of authority the second they cheat, lie, or steal. Imagine having a recourse against police brutality, this most violent street gang in America, and actually hiring good and honest, constitutionally minded men and women to protect and serve the people, against government and corporate tyranny, not to protect the crimes, taxes, and fines imposed by corporations and municipalities. And then imagine bringing judges, lawyers, attorneys, and politicians to justice by grand jury indictments for criminal behavior in an official capacity. Imagine a government that invests in research and development for the actual cures for cancer and other diseases, as opposed to turning cancer into the most profitable business in the medical field by prescribing cancer-causing radiation and chemotherapy by force, while outlawing natural cures and preventative research and products. Imagine building a better widget and actually being able to compete in the global market, without corporations squashing the most brilliant of ideas simply because they aren't profitable or patentable, or because they might make outdated and polluting corporate standards like oil, coal, or AC/DC electricity less in demand. And imagine no property tax, no sales tax, no estate or death tax. And once again, imagine no taxation without representation. All of this is possible by simply setting up a tax retirement fund in any city, county, township, state, even federal government. Taxation is not needed, as you can see from all of these funds. Walter Burian has estimated that just in pension funds alone across the country, there is approximately $36 trillion worth of investments. Now, we're throwing around some pretty big numbers here. Most people can't even imagine what $1 million looks like, let alone $1 billion or $1 trillion. But to give you an idea of what $1 trillion is, try to imagine $1 million and then multiply that by another million. $1 trillion is a million million. And that means that just in pension funds alone across the United States, there are $36 million dollars in assets and investments. This is theft and tyranny. And the craziest part about it is that it is hidden in plain sight. But no longer. For here in front of you is the proof that our government is not only a for-profit major conglomerate world corporation, but that it has been stealing and investing taxpayer money against the will of the people, with little to no disclosure about that stolen money, through collective government investments. I, for one, wholeheartedly support Walter Burian in his efforts, and hope that you too can see the benefit of what he is trying to do for you and your family's future. If we do not do something about this, and soon, the whole world is going to be gobbled up by these corporations, and the people will continue to suffer, to lose their jobs, to lose their homes, and to lose all prosperity, life, liberty, and the happiness that this country was founded on. Now, let's take a look at the CalSTRS Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for June 30th of 2009. This year's theme is transparency. But I think they're being a little bit too transparent for this type of criminal activity. On the introduction page, it lists the usual words of encouragement from the head crook. And in this introduction is the section called Transparency and Governance. It states, "We believe there is a universal standard for good corporate governance. It includes transparency and disclosure of broad activities and engaging companies to help maximize their performance, a best practice that we've followed for years." Once again, an admission of corporatism and fascism. Good corporate governance is an important factor in maintaining the long-term value of CalSTRS portfolio companies, and we intend to protect that value for the benefit of California's educators. Yeah. Our corporate governance policies address leading issues such as proxy access. As a long-term owner and lender to corporations around the world, CalSTRS' duty is to protect these assets through the pursuit of good governance and operational accountability. Again, an admission of guilt. This is a pension fund acting as government for corporations. Information is vital for shareholders to make informed decisions about the companies they own, and CalSTRS intends to let fellow shareholders, as well as management, government, know how we intend to vote. And as we see, the net assets held in trust for pension and other post-employment benefits at the end of business year 2009 was $118,430,073,000. Once again, reported in thousands, meaning we add three zeros. At the beginning of the year, it was $161 billion, and we can see that CalSTRS is reporting a negative year in the amount of $43,068,120,000. But what is absolutely necessary to comprehend in the case of figures like this is that these monetary values are not what you should be looking at. Stocks and the market that they represent will always go up and down, as you can see by CalSTRS Table 1, Growth in Total Investments, listed in millions. Here is the year 2000, as we just covered, at $112 billion. And you'll notice that it went up to $171,899,000,000. And with the economic instability and crises of 2008 and 2009, we're back down to $118,875,000,000. Now again, the monetary value here is not what you should be paying attention to, for it is not the sparkly things that hold the value. The real value of CalSTRS' stock portfolio is its percentage of ownership in these companies, for percentage of ownership equals percentage of proxy voting rights. And as we can see in Table 5, listed as the largest equity holdings as of June 30th, 2009, we see that CalSTRS held on to its General Electric stock. But as of 2009, it's gone up to 40,838,000 shares of General Electric stock. That represents a significant change of ownership within General Electric by the CalSTRS pension fund. Its ownership in General Electric stock has gone up by 75% in 9 years, which means that its ownership of General Electric and the votes it casts on behalf of General Electric have also gone up by 75%. We can also see that its ownership in ExxonMobil Corporation has increased by more than 8 million shares in the last 9 years, representing about an 80% increase in ownership of Exxon. Microsoft Corporation stock has doubled from 15 million shares in 2000 to 30 million shares in 2009. And now, topping the list of stock investments, we have Johnson & Johnson at 10.6 million shares, AT&T Incorporated at 23.399 million shares, International Business Machines at 5.3 million shares, Procter & Gamble at 10.6 million shares, Chevron Corporation at 8 million shares, J.P. Morgan Chase & Company, 15 million shares, and Apple Incorporated at about 3.5 million shares. More proof that Apple is equally as controlled as Microsoft when it comes to corporate governance. And again on page 74, CalSTRS dedicates a page to its corporate governance. This year, CalSTRS staff voted on 61,950 proxy proposals submitted by 4,087 corporations that are held in the CalSTRS portfolio. And this 61,950 proposals represented a 30.5% increase from the 47,481 proposals voted on in 2007 and 2008. And it shows that the major proxy issues voted on are summarized below, which are election of directors, selection of auditors, mergers and acquisitions, corporate actions and corporate governance issues, and other miscellaneous issues. On page 50, CalSTRS lists its foreign currency risk. Listed in thousands, we see where CalSTRS is hedging its American dollars. Australia, Brazil, England, Canada, Chile, Colombia, the Czech Republic, Egypt, the European Union, Japan, China, India, and on, for a total of $22,273,247,000. This represents the securities purchased in a foreign country. Again, CalSTRS continues its banking practices. It states that the investment figures are comprised of numerous portfolios within the international equity, debt securities, private equity, and real estate investment line items on the statement of fiduciary net assets. And of course, CalSTRS is still paying its investment managers' fees to the tune of $124,414,000, and we can't forget its global equity broker commissions for a total of $44,598,000. Once again, the monetary value of this fund is not what you should be looking at. The ownership in Fortune 500 and other corporations is what is important here. The stock market can go up and down as much as it wants, because when it's down, they'll buy more stock. When it's up, they'll either hold on to it or sell it, knowing that it will go back down at a later date, and then CalSTRS can purchase more ownership stock in these corporations. This is the monetary shell game played by collective government. And for a final understanding of how much money is out there in this collective government, let's just take a look at a few more governments and municipalities from around the country. Let's start with my hometown and the capital of California, Sacramento. In its 2009 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, under the Management's Discussion and Analysis, It states under the financial highlights section that the city's total government-wide net assets, excluding discretely presented component unit, increased $41.1 million to $2.5 billion in 2009, an increase of 1.7% over 2008. And under the financial analysis of the government-wide statements, it states that total assets, listed in millions, for 2009, total $3.845 million, slightly up from 2008. Listing its total liabilities at $1.3 billion, we have total net assets at $2.518 million for the city of Sacramento. And that's important, because this is only the city government or municipality of Sacramento and its summary of net assets. But what about the county of Sacramento? Again, the county of Sacramento is a totally different government. And within its comprehensive annual financial report for the year 2009, again under the financial highlights section, it states that the assets of the county exceeded liabilities at the close of the 2008-2009 fiscal year by $2,547,254. And under its statement of net assets for the year ended June 30th, 2009, expressed in thousands of dollars, we see the total for liabilities and net assets equals in the positive, meaning its assets outweigh its liabilities, by $6,712,350,000. So Sacramento County ain't doing so bad. Ah, but the biggest mistake one can make when examining these financial statements is to look at this first section, the stated net assets. It's as if it is there to throw you off the scent. For the real assets of each of these corporate governments is always hidden further down within the last of the 100 to 300 pages of the CAFR. In those required pages are listed the many types of funds and off-balance sheet operations and business that each government is involved in. Generally speaking, the majority of the wealth of America is tied up in these funds, especially the state and local pension funds. Many funds are cleverly portrayed as future planning for such things as roads, bridges, construction, etc. But each of these funds has their own investments, and as the fund grows by return on those investments, or from interest earnings, this extra money is kept within the fund. It is often moved into other funds and reinvested there, or may be loaned out, or allocated to other government debts or functions. So a fund may be set up with the expectation to grow into $1 billion at the end of 20 years, assigned enough taxpayer money through taxation to eventually reach that goal. But at the end of that 20 years, or sooner, regardless of need or of the taxpayer's will, there is no contract requiring that fund to be used for its originally intended purpose. And it is often reabsorbed into the government or other funds and investments. Or, the principal balance of that fund will be used for the required road, bridge, or other project, but all of the profit from that investment fund goes elsewhere. There are multiple types of these funds for each incorporated state, district, county, city, local, and other types of governments. Sacramento County is, of course, invested in the California Public Employees Retirement System, or CalPERS. And the more government employees, the better for the fund, since each employee enrolled in this pension fund for state workers requires by law that their state employers contribute to the fund as well. Of course, that is taxpayer money that is being contributed on behalf of these state employees, since taxpayer money funds these government offices. Thus, the intent and motive for the creation of government jobs and the hiring and firing of state employees is based more on profit for the state and local pension funds, way more than it is for just government-related business need. So let's take a look at the CalPERS CAFR. As we examine this financial report, we again get a look into the vast amounts of wealth that California holds in its pension funds. Dwarfing the California State Teachers Retirement Pension Fund, the CalPERS Summary of Investments for its Public Employee Retirement Fund shows a total investment value of $197,102,773,341. It also shows real estate investments at almost $20 billion. Now, on page 93 of 198 pages, CalPERS makes a very lame attempt at trying to show that it reinvests in the state of California, with California investments totaling $14,877,000,000. However, in this almost $200 billion fund, it's fairly obvious that CalPERS is invested in Fortune 500 and foreign corporations. And here again we have the largest stock holdings for CalPERS, and it appears to be the usual suspects, with stock investments in ExxonMobil Corporation at 14.2 million shares, Microsoft Corporation at 23.1 million shares, Johnson & Johnson at 7.6 million shares, AT&T at 17 million shares, Procter & Gamble Company at 8 million shares, International Business Machines at 3.9 million shares, Chevron Corporation at 6.1 million shares, J.P. Morgan Chase Company at 11.1 million shares, Apple Computers, once again, at 2.5 million shares, and Walmart rounds out the top 10 at 7.2 million shares. It also lists its largest bond holdings, listed in thousands and showing billions and billions of dollars worth of bond holdings. And it seems like everybody's invested in the Tennessee Valley Authority. And interestingly, and what seems to me a bit of a conflict of interest, is that it's having J.P. Morgan Securities as one of its larger brokers. I find it hard to believe that there is not some conflict of interest in having major stock holdings in the company that is your broker. And we see that the total commission and broker fees for the pension fund is $84,418,000. And at the end of it all, we see that net assets held in trust for pension and other post-employment benefits equals $178,899,883,000. Plus a little over $1 billion in other California funds. And now you understand where a lot of this government money is being hidden, within the pension and other funds. Here's the Ohio State Teachers CAFR. And once again, similar to CalSTRS, though on a lesser scale, we see that net assets held in trust for pensions and other post-employment benefits are at $8,024,889,206. Now, this documentary wouldn't be complete if I didn't include the Salt Lake City Corporation, would it? According to Salt Lake City Corporation's comprehensive annual financial report, year ending June 30th, 2009, under its financial highlights section, it states that the assets of Salt Lake City, the city, exceeded its liabilities at the end of the current fiscal year by $2,116,861,947. Of this amount, nearly $479 million are unrestricted net assets and available to meet ongoing obligations to citizens and creditors. Net assets for year 2009 increased by $65.9 million. It also states that the city's governmental funds reported combining ending fund balance of $119.2 million, an increase of $28.7 million compared to the prior year's ending amount. Of the combined total fund balance, almost $44 million is available for spending at the discretion of the city, unreserved and undesignated fund balance. Here we see just how much the city receives in property taxes at $66,608,000. Other taxes it receives at $75,650,000. And the total liabilities and net assets equate to $2,589,079,000. It even lists its component library unit at a value of $34,377,000. And finally, we come to the revenue section. General property taxes at $66 million, interest it receives from investments at $2.3 million, and the personal thorn in my side, parking tickets at $3,969,193. Licenses, permits, fines and forfeitures, assessments, interest, intergovernmental, parking meters, charges for services, contributions, sales use and excise taxes, franchise taxes. These serve to benefit no one, and the total revenues collected from the people of the municipality or corporation of Salt Lake City equate to $191 million just in fines and fees. Again, we see corruption at its finest. And we see that the fund balance, which represents all of these fees and other usurious activities, is in the black at $24,258,000. Meanwhile, unemployment is on the rise, vacant housing and strip malls have become commonplace, and property and other taxes are continuously being raised. Now again, we just made the mistake of taking this statement of net assets as the total government assets, without taking into consideration the enterprise operations, operating investment funds, and pension funds listed towards the end of the report. Now in the Salt Lake CAFR, it states that the city participates in three cost-sharing multiple employer public retirement systems, PERS, PERS, and one multiple employer agent PERS. And it references the Public Safety Retirement System, and it goes into the actuarial rates and asset values. So let's take a look at Utah Retirement Systems, a component unit of the state of Utah. Their comprehensive annual financial report includes the non-contributory retirement system, contributory retirement system, public safety retirement system, firefighters retirement system, judges retirement system, governors and legislators retirement plan, 401k and 457 plans, Roth and traditional IRA plans, and health reimbursement arrangement, or HRA. It states that the fair value of assets as of January 1, 2009, was $15,886,000 and grew by almost $2 billion to a fair market value of $17,717,000 as of December 31, 2009. Also, it states the actuarial value of these assets, which are available for benefits, is at $20,818,000. Once again, we get into our corporate governance section, and the state pension fund has its list of largest assets held. ExxonMobil, Apple, JPMorgan Chase, Microsoft, Google, Hewlett-Packard, Cisco Systems, Pfizer, Wells Fargo, and AT&T. Once again, this represents ownership in all of these companies, and these are just the top 10. And once again, we see the conflict of interest by having JPMorgan Chase as a broker. And we see that the total of fees and commissions paid for this particular fund was $4,367,000. Now, in its other fund, again, we have a different list of largest assets held, and we see that it includes the same stocks, with Apple Computers, Google, Microsoft Corporation, Hewlett-Packard, Cisco Systems, Qualcomm, JPMorgan Chase, ExxonMobil, Visa, and Schlumberger Limited. And lots of money invested in debt securities. And so once again, we can see where the state of Utah, the city of Salt Lake, and the county of Salt Lake are stashing and investing their money. Now, There is one final curtain that needs to be unveiled here. The Federal Reserve has been a hot topic of conversation among those in the Truth and Freedom movement. And leading the pack, with his winning smile and stoic persona, is the lovable congressman by the name of Ron Paul. Mr. Paul is the leading advocate of not only ending the central bank in the form of the Federal Reserve, but also of auditing this horrendous bank as well. But audit is an interesting choice of words to use for his cause, since Ron Paul is fully aware that the Federal Reserve is obligated under federal law to submit a comprehensive annual financial report to the federal government. While I respect and admire Congressman Paul, sadly, as a congressman, he is equally complicit in the cover-up of these financial audits in the form of CAFRs. The Comprehensive Annual Financial Report is the audit of the Federal Reserve, and he knows this. But to his credit, he also knows that it is literally political suicide to talk openly about the CAFRs in any public forum, even in congressional session. He has a family, and he knows they would be in danger if he went too far on this subject. Does this make Mr. Paul a bad guy? Well, I'm not a judge. That is for the individual to decide. For on one side, he has his well-being and family to protect. He also, however, as all legislators do, has a multi-million dollar discretionary tax-exempt expense account to protect. While I'll give him the benefit of the doubt that his silence on this subject is purely political and protectionary, not wanting to lose his political gain in an otherwise good old boy government, I now challenge Ron Paul to come clean, with this documentary as his tool, and once and for all to prove his loyalty is first to the people for which he represents, and not to the continuity of the corporate government. And now, my gift to you, Dr. Paul, my hero, pending your action and public discourse on the matters discussed herein. Let's take a look at the audit of the Federal Reserve Bank through its comprehensive annual financial report. First, in order to provide proof that Ron Paul is telling the truth about the Fed, I found this to be a very telling piece of evidence. This is a clipping from a federal case involving Lewis versus the United States, cited as 680 F2D1239, from the year 1982, and it refers to federal tort claims involving the Federal Reserve. Here it states that the Court of Appeals held that the Federal Reserve banks are not federal instrumentalities for purposes of the Act, but are independent, privately owned, and locally controlled corporations. As far as determining what is a federal agency, the critical factor is the existence of federal government control over detailed physical performance and the day-to-day operation of an entity. Again, it states Federal Reserve banks are not federal instrumentalities for the purposes of federal torts claims, but are independent, privately owned, and locally controlled corporations. It also states that Federal Reserve banks receive no appropriated funds from Congress, and the banks are empowered to sue and be sued in their own names. Here it states each bank is statutorily empowered to conduct these activities without day-to-day direction from the federal government. So the Federal Reserve is acting completely independent from the federal government. The interest rates on advances to member banks, individual partnerships, and corporations are set by each reserve, and their decisions regarding the purchase and sale of securities are likewise independently made. Now remember, this is the bank, the private international bank, that your federal income tax is going so that it can print our money. It also states in the past the banks have defended against tort claims directly through private counsel, not government attorneys. But we also mustn't forget that the reserve banks, which further the nation's fiscal policy, clearly perform an important governmental function. This is the bank that makes the economy go up and down whenever it wants. I guess that's important. And finally, it states that plaintiffs are not without a forum in which to seek a remedy, for they may bring an appropriate state tort claim directly against the bank. And if successful, their prospects of recovery are bright, since the institutions are both highly solvent and amply insured. Well, I wanted to know how highly solvent these banks really were. And so I pulled up the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for the Federal Reserve 2008. Now, this is a very long report, and so we're just going to go through a few key pages on the report. Here, in a letter to the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Mr. Ben Bernanke, the President of the Federal Reserve, states that pursuant to the requirements of Section 10 of the Federal Reserve Act, I am pleased to submit the 99th Annual Report of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System. This report covers operations of the Board during calendar year 2008. Now, moving to page 416, under the Statement of Condition of the Federal Reserve Banks by Bank, and listed in millions of dollars, as of December 31st, 2009, the accumulative holdings in the Federal Reserve's gold certificate account was $11,037,000,000 worth of gold. Now, do you really want to go to the gold standard? You can see here who has control of gold: government and its corporations. And a little farther down the page, we see that the Federal Reserve has total assets of $2,248,534,000,000. And then just a little farther down, we get to the gold mine. This is what everyone talks about. Under payments to U.S. Treasury, described as interest on Federal Reserve notes, we have the total for all banks at $31,688,000,000 in interest on the dollar on Federal Reserve notes. That is a very significant part of the national debt. This is interest on the dollar that the U.S. government owes a private institution, a private international corporation, for the use of its paper, something that the U.S. government could do itself without interest of any kind. This is the very definition of usury. Absolutely unnecessary and corrupt. And at the bottom it shows that the Federal Reserve has a surplus as of December 31st of $21,075,000,000, which is up from the beginning of the year by about $2.5 billion. That's a heck of a profit. On page 445, it has the number and annual salaries of officers and employees of the Federal Reserve Banks. And in the totals section for just the New York Federal Reserve Bank, these boys are getting paid $293,025,032. With the total annual salaries of officers and employees of the Federal Reserve Banks at $1,383,973,408. Funny, that's about what David Walker said that the deficit of the federal government is.
We had a $1.4 trillion deficit last year. We expect to have about $1.4 trillion deficit this year.
I think we just found a cure for our wounded federal government. Now, as we know, Timothy Geithner quit the Federal Reserve Bank to take an appointment by President Obama as the Treasury Secretary. Here is his severance pay. It states that in January 2009, the Board of Governors, at the request of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York's Board of Directors, approved a special separation payment of $434,686 to Bank President Timothy Geithner. And on January 1 of each year, all presidents receive salary increases equal to the percentage increase in the midpoint of their respective salary ranges. Wow. And once again, we see that Deloitte and Touche is the independent auditor chosen by the Board of Governors for the Federal Reserve. And here it states, the financial statements of the Board of Governors for 2008 and 2007 were audited, an audit of the Federal Reserve by Deloitte and Touche, independent auditors. And finally, we get to page 486, where it refers to the Government Accountability Office reviews. Where have we heard that office before? Ah, David Walker, the Auditor General of the United States, of course. You see, it turns out that under the Federal Banking Agency Audit Act, Public Law 95-320, most Federal Reserve System operations are under the purview of the Government Accountability Office, or GAO. Huh. The reports are available directly from the GAO. So there you go, Ron Paul. Why don't you just go to the Comptroller General of the United States and just grab the reports from him? There's your audit of the Federal Reserve. Now get on it, man. So if you really want an audit of the Federal Reserve, here's the man to talk to. He knew what was going on the whole time he was in office, because the Federal Reserve and other branches of the federal government have to go through this man and get those audits approved by the government accounting office that he represented. All the secrets of the Federal Reserve are within this man's corrupt head. Now, in the interest of time, this brings me to the end of my presentation. So what is the solution here? Well, corporations are people, too, but they're not real people. They are fictional persons. They are straw men. They are not real. And corporations can be dissolved. They are not your government, though they like to think they are. A republic government is a group of representative officials, and you do not have that. And you do not have a constitution to protect you. Now, on that note, the comprehensive annual financial reports that I've been referencing were from 2009, most of them ending June 30. But the stock market has gone up by almost 3,000 points since then, which would represent about a 40% increase, at least, in the value of the stocks held in these funds and government accounts. The 2010 Comprehensive Annual Financial Reports are due out at any time, and I would invite you to examine them yourselves and to see the astronomical gains that government has probably gained in the last year. What we've talked about here is corporate fascism, admitted in the financial reports of the federal and local, state, county, and other corporate governance across the United States. We have a problem. We cannot change this corrupt system of corporate fascism from within the current corporate structure of government. Washington, D.C. is its own country. It is a foreign corporation that is not part of the 50 states united. This is the best-kept secret of our time. We cannot trust in the two-party system of government. This is not a question of voting them out, perpetually changing between the two dominant political parties. The definition of insane is indeed to repeat the same action over and over, electing the same media-driven candidates, the media being owned by government, and insanely expecting different results. This is a different kind of lesson that we all must learn, perhaps the hardest medicine of our lives. For we, the people of the United States of America, are no longer governed by the Constitution for the United States of America, nor are our politicians bound in any way by its republic form of governance. In fact, some corporate cities and townships are now passing laws which blatantly state that their elected and appointed officials are not bound by any oath that they take. Tremont, Utah, near me, to name just one. If you are part of an activist group such as We Are Change, End the Fed, the Tea Party, or any other group out there, you must understand that this is truly the only issue that is viable in the fight to take our country back. This is the holy grail of information. This must be comprehended in order to understand why things like 9/11, the Federal Reserve's powers, and political parties and lobbies have a tyrannical grasp on all of us. You cannot fight against a well-oiled corporate machine unless you understand the machine before you plan your battle. You must release your hope that the Obama administration or any future corporate officer and CEO of the United States will change this system of corporate fascism in America. You must release your media-driven beliefs, which have no foundation in fact, beliefs that blind you from reality with public opinion spun out of control by the corporate government-controlled network of propaganda and lies. And you must release your faith that government is good most of the time, that government has the best interest of the people at heart, that elected, but mostly unelected and appointed, corporate officials aren't involved in a long-term plan to rob you and your future generations land, wealth, and prosperity. For a corporation has but one purpose, and one purpose only, to ensure profit for its stockholders, and that is not we, the people. There is but one viable solution that I have seen for this corporate takeover of our homeland and the world around us. That solution comes from a man named Walter Burian, and he calls it a tax retirement fund. Walter has been instrumental in the fight to bring awareness of not only the corporate structure of government to the attention of the masses, but to expose this truth with their own comprehensive annual financial reports. No matter who you are, no matter what your job is, what social class you fall under, or what political affiliation you think of yourself as, all of this doesn't matter anymore. Your reality, your paradigm, must change now, with the information you now hold. You must break free of political parties, break free of the clever hope and change mantra and political rhetoric, and you must break free of the fear and entertainment that is constantly shrouded over you to keep you dumbed down to the truth. Turn your television off. Get mad as hell and yell from your window that you are not going to take it anymore. Please get in touch with Walter Burian at CAFR1.com, where he will receive your calls and instruct you on how you can utilize his knowledge to bring his tax retirement fund solution to a public vote in your local government, with citizens voting to bring all of these investments back into the public's hands to fund the future of your city or county, state or township, while forcing a complete open book audit of every financial transaction in your corporate venue. Only we, as people united in the pursuit of freedom, can restructure and reinvent our government, placing it back into the constitutional realm of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, without taxation of any kind. This is our last hope. Please join me in supporting Walter Burian and CAFR1.com and bringing tax retirement funds to your local county and state governments. Please, please make this video go viral.
America needs a full-time president, and a full-time Congress.
Intends to remain the master of its own house.
Well, he failed. Leave Iraq or be driven out, failed. The Middle East, the Baghdad, failed. Fail. And he came back from Baghdad with no progress at all. Fail. To reach a peaceful resolution. Withdraw from Iraq. Withdraw from Iraq.
To restore pride at home.
Withdraw from Iraq. Withdraw from Iraq.
And respect abroad.
Withdraw from Iraq. The Middle East. The Baghdad. The Middle East. The Baghdad. The Middle East, the Baghdad, when we invaded the Middle East. Iraq, a member of the Arab League, a member of the United Nations, was crushed. Its people brutalized. War, war, war. war. We subjected the people to unspeakable atrocities. War. And among those maimed and murdered, innocent children. War. Move out of Iraq in accord with the United Nations resolutions. War. The answer is clear. War. Move out of Iraq. War. War.
Hanging by the slenderest of threads, capable of being cut at any moment by accident or miscalculation or by madness, the weapons of war must be abolished before they abolish us.